This is the D6 Generation with your hosts, Craig Gallant.
You're on! If you're getting any compensation, it's not charity!
Russ Wakelin. You put me on a boat with freaking dragons attacking me and whatnot? Now we're talking. And Raef, Hollywood Granger.
Now that's Jimmy Django right there.
With contribution from Total Fangirl.
Vampires do not sparkle.
And our loyal listener.
One game is very like another till the D6G reviews it, brother.
Welcome to another edition of Rapid Fire, the roundtable discussion of all things gaming. Coming at with the speed of a podcast host hopped up on Starbucks coffee, steak and shake shakes, not enough sleep, and too much excitement. Today's edition is brought to you by the Gaming Geek, the source for your miniature gaming needs at some of the most competitive pricing on eBay. Currently stocking Dystopian Wars, Warhammer 40K, Dust Tactics, and Malifaux. We've got the new 40K Grey Knights and Dark Eldar releases, along with a just-received shipment of Malifaux goodness. Find them at store.ebay.com/the-gaming-geek.
We've got to shorten that one.
I'm Caitlin Minergan, your host today. As always, our panelists are Russ, the Ghost Whisperer, Wakelin, and what? Raef, the Ghost Granger, with a very special guest, the GenCon D6 listenership mob. Let's begin. Issue number one.
Sign language?
Attention span is the amount of time that a person can concentrate on a task without becoming distracted. Estimates for the length of human attention span are highly variable and depend on the precise definition of attention being used. Focused attention is a short-term response to a specific stimulus. 8 seconds is often regarded as the average, whereas sustained attention is the specific focus on a certain task and can be seen as high as 20 minutes. Question. Given how intently focused many people are on their smartphones, Twitter accounts, texts, and such, even when surrounded by such an amazing array of humanity as Gen Con, on a scale of 1 through 10, with 1 being a zombie squirrel and 10 being a dedicated idiot AI, where has personal communication technology put our average attention spans according to most researchers? Gordon Alport Granger.
4.5.
Wilhelm Wundt Wakelin.
6.7.
Milton Erickson Mob. Please, recent research has actually indicated, for real, that internet-savvy individuals don't even have the same neural pathways as the rest of us. That is a definitive negative 10. Issue number two. When traveling to a convention or tournament that is not entirely centrally located in regards to the rest of the country, one is often forced to fly on a commercial carrier. Further, given the nature of these various events, it is often necessary for a traveler to check baggage even when their personal preference is not to. For instance, when they have an entire suitcase full of prizes to give away. In short, a traveler suddenly finds themselves at the mercy of a large, faceless organization with little or no immediate recourse should something go horribly, irrevocably wrong. Question. Given the myriad things that could happen to a hapless suitcase in the belly of a commercial jet, what percentage of luggage in the United States is lost each year? Raji Airlines Ross.
20.
Percent. Raven Air Raef.
3.
Marcos Aviation Mob.
10.
Oh, we'll say 15%? Wow. Wow. This could have not been, but it is wrong! Believe it or not, I thought this was a high number, and then you guys are at 15%, 20%. One person in 150 will find themselves arriving sans luggage yearly in the U.S. It's okay, though. The U.K., it's even worse. But not 15 to 20%. Issue number three. Like agoraphobia is an anxiety disorder defined as a morbid fear of having a panic attack. Are the doors closed? Good. Or like symptoms in a situation that is perceived to be difficult or embarrassing from which to escape. These situations can include wide open spaces, crowds, or uncontrolled social conditions. As a result, sufferers of agoraphobia avoid public and or unfamiliar places, especially large open spaces such as shopping malls, airports, or gaming conventions, from which they cannot easily escape. Question. Should someone suddenly develop an agoraphobic tendency at Gen Con? What is the best location for them to retreat to in order to establish a safe distance from the chaos? Greek Islands Granger.
The park.
Madam Walker Theater Wakelin.
Top of a building.
Monument Circle Mob. Fantasy Flight Booth. Have you been there? Once again. Wrong! Ladies and gentlemen, day or night, rain or shine, there's no safer place at Gen Con than the furry LARPer costume booth. Woo! Barring those, of course, there's always that little niche under the skyway on the side of the Marriott. Issue number four. In the Dungeons & Dragons fantasy, anybody played True Dungeon yet? Okay. In the Dungeons & Dragons fantasy roleplay game, the Lich is an undead creature, a spellcaster, who seeks to defy death by magical means. The Lich was one of the first monsters ever mentioned in D&D, appearing in the very first supplement, Greyhawk, in 1975. A Lich converts itself into a skeletal creature by means of necromancy, storing its soul in a secret magical receptacle, and thus can never be killed until the receptacle can be destroyed. Question. What is this magical receptacle called? And no, it's not a Horcrux. Red Eye Russ.
Big B.
Wrong.
Holding ball.
Thessalar Raef.
A flux capacitor.
Mellifloor Mob.
Woo!
Wrong! Wrong! Correct! Yay! You got one right! Phylactery! That's right, phylactery! And it's even corrected on the spell check. That's it for now. Thanks for listening and good night!
This episode of the D6 Generation is brought to you by
Myriad Games, the friendly professional gaming store of the D6 Generation.
And by Battle Foam, protecting your army so you don't have to.
And by Lone Wolf Development, take your game to the next level.
And the War Store, bringing the war to your door since 1999, and that is for a decade or more.
And by Audible, try the service, get a free book, and support the show. All by visiting audibletrial.com/D6G. Oh!
Hello.
Yo, what's up?
And welcome to episode 85 of the D6 Generation, live at GenCon!
Yay!
We're really excited about today's achievements because not only do we have all these great GenCon folks here for achievements, we have Total Fangirl in the house as well.
Hello. Yep.
And we're going to go through, we're going to ask some of you folks here, before we get into exactly achievements.
He's Russ Wakelin.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
I'm Craig Gallon, and that's over there, that's Raef Hollywood Granger.
Hey, he said my nickname.
Very cool.
I always go last. Sarcasm. That's what I was waiting on. I'd like to welcome all the listeners, too.
Anyway.
Who could make it to Gen Con.
Yeah, okay.
You're with us in spirit.
You just keep going.
We want to have a special thanks here for everybody at Game On with Cody and John.
Yay, John.
It's awesome.
John's waving from the back.
And gamesalute.com helps get everything set up here today as well for the space. We're really excited about it. Thanks all of you guys for coming out today.
Yeah, thank
you. Got a lot of seats filled, which is awesome. But what's the time for now, Craig?
Achievement. Gaming.
Bloop.
Oh. Thanks, John.
Thanks, John. Achievements in Gaming is brought to all of you at Gen Con today by What Would Patton Do Podcast, the best source of all things Flames of War, featuring in-depth discussions on strategies, tactics, and armies, along with all things gaming. Check out our blog and podcast on the web at whatwouldpattondo.net. And no, I did not just insert that in the middle of the Gen Con recording. No, really, it happened live, honestly.
So what we're going to do for today's very special achievements, we want to do
like an after-school special.
It is very special. We want to ask. We're going to ask some questions of everyone here, including ourselves, of what you've seen so far at Gen Con and what you're liking so far. So, the show of hands first out there, folks. What things have you seen so far that have lived up to your expectations that match the hype? Nicole, you want to go out there and
okay, some talk.
Blood Bowl, the card game, which a month ago didn't exist according to half the internet, and a year ago was announced and finally was released at Gen Con and blew me away. It was very, very good. So
who liked Blood Bowl Team Manager? Have you seen it yet? Applause. Pretty good.
Three guys loved it.
Yeah, I actually played it last night. It's pretty cool. Have you tried it yet, Ray?
I saw it. I'm impressed.
Is
I think
it sold
it looks
out
really
already?
Cool.
Do we know?
Yes. It's gone already? Sold out.
Gone, yeah. Well,
there you go.
Boom. Wow. A couple of our local guys got it, so we're cool.
Does it play like the game, the board game?
No,
it's a totally different game.
Oh, it is.
Okay, let's move on. We're eating another 20 minutes.
Wow, all right. No more comments.
I wanted to know.
Wow, look at you go. All right. What was the most unexpected thing someone saw at Gen Con?
Give yourself a shout out. Say who you are, too.
Yeah, right.
I'm Joe from Poughkeepsie.
Kevin Hart from Indianapolis. The husband and wife pyramid head costumes. Adorable.
I didn't
That's
see that.
Good. I like that. I haven't seen that one. So costumes... Anyone else, real quick?
Cool. Another
one? Most unexpected
Just yell it
thing?
Out. Go ahead.
Go ahead, yell it out.
I yell it?
Yeah, go ahead.
I got
I was actually surprised by the Star Wars announcement. It just kind of snuck up on me. So
what didn't it, though? Stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I've kind of fallen out with Star Wars, but then I was like, you know what? This looks cool. So,
yeah. Okay.
How many of you watched or playtested that new fighter game?
X-Wing. I played
way more people than the Blood Bowl, just saying.
Yeah, X-Wing was awesome. Who played the card game? Anybody played the Star Wars card game? Nice.
Awesome, yeah.
Good show of hands.
Very
there.
Exciting.
We'll do a shoot of applause if you can hear at home. Yeah, it's about
yay! Applause. Right. I don't understand what you just said.
I don't either. Okay. Along.
You need notes for this?
I do. I don't forget. What about most buzz? What about the thing that had the most buzz that you've heard since you've been here? What's getting talked about the most? Maybe it was Star Wars. Anything else?
Quarriers. Absolutely.
Quarriers?
How many of you have played Quarriors so far? Yeah, I liked it.
Nice.
Nice. There you go. Nice effort.
Yeah. In the applause thing. Yeah, because people at home won't be able to see the hands. That's
what's he has one.
Oh, look, there it is right
there. Quarriers in the back there.
Still sealed in its commemorative tin.
What's the price for Quarriers?
$50.
$50. Okay, fair enough.
I heard.
And cheap at half the price.
And is it worth the price?
This is what it's
is it
like,
worth
folks.
You get a good quality in there?
Even live.
Demo cards.
Nice.
What about Ninjatsu? I heard somebody yell that out, and I heard that was a pretty amazing thing.
Yeah, it's a local designer.
Yep.
Adam West. He also designed...
Not Batman?
Batman?
Batman. Adam West also designed Galactic Emperor. He's from Indianapolis. It's a very cool game.
Very cool. And it's, on that and one, it's sold out, right? Gone.
It sold out like 5
wow.
seconds.
Yeah, 5
wow.
seconds.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard that's good.
So what are you guys seeing played in the streets, in the rooms and stuff at Gen Con? Have you seen anything interesting being played? What's being bought and played? Like right in Cody Street.
Food Fight.
John Street.
Food Fight. Yeah. I have food not fight? Seen Food Fight. How many of you have seen Food Fight being played? Wow, a lot of people. Okay.
The Food Fight demo booth is pretty cool. If you've seen it yet, it's got like it's all done up like picnic tables, and it's like a little place.
I find the artwork disturbing. The food looks dirty.
It is a little disturbing.
I like the little French fries in the tank. There was yeah,
but they look.
I played that.
We all got a big sticker with it in our bag.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that that's a card game, right? Is that a card driven game?
Yep.
Yeah. Thank you.
Not
Thank
wrong.
You. Thank you. Okay. What about? Let's go on to category specific RPGs. What's the coolest RPG so far we've seen here?
Uh-oh.
Is there any
Uh-oh.
New hotness in the RPG realm?
Pathfinder is the big...
Pathfinder?
Pathfinder. What's new about it, though? Okay,
Ultimate
so there's
Combat.
A new book being released called Ultimate Combat.
Yeah, it was released here at the con, right? And a little plug for Lone Wolf, also released the add-on for Hero Lab at the same time.
Oh, that's
Ultimate
right.
Combat.
Yep.
Fiasco.
Oh, Fiasco.
Now, what's that?
What's Fiasco? Oh, he's eating while he's talking. This is like Granger. You must be a Hollywood fan.
Yeah.
Really, in layman's terms, it is a choose-your-own Coen Brothers adventure.
Oh.
Get
that's
out.
Cool. That's
nice.
Fun. That's fun.
I have to cool. go check that out.
Right. And anybody pick up the new, what's that little game that Fantasy Flight? That
Black game? Crusade.
Black Crusade. Anybody get that?
Oh, yeah. I got
Some
it.
Nice
got
my artwork.
Copy. All right. It does look cool.
I like the Savage World booth, too. They got a lot of good stuff
they
coming
do,
out.
Yeah. Savage World.
Yeah,
Deluxe,
Savage
yeah.
World Deluxe.
Yeah.
I'm seeing a lot of new. It seems like last year at Gen Con, everything you saw wasn't out yet. It seems like this year they're releasing a lot of stuff at the con. Is that true? Show applause. Do you think that's the case? This
what
year?
You want is it available right now?
Yeah.
Except for shooting.
A couple people are very excited about that. Everybody else not so sure.
Right.
Maybe it wasn't a good question.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see. I played the demo. Who's played the demo of Leviathans? You got to register for it. Yeah, you got to register for
it. It's Catalyst Games, I believe.
Yeah,
but if you play 14 or 15, they give you a big model.
Yeah, you get a little boat, really. And then you can trade up.
You got to trade up. You get a little boat for doing the first one, and then a medium boat, and then a big boat for the third one.
It's worth checking out. It's pretty interesting.
It is kind of like a carnival game.
Yeah, that part is. What about miniature gaming hotness? What's the hotness in miniature gaming? Anyone?
Puppet Wars.
That was almost universal. Like 10 people shouted that out. Avatars for Malifaux? Malifaux avatars? Yeah, they're booth. They're the stuff they got, not pre-painted, the stuff they got painted on the cases looks awesome.
Yeah,
beautiful stuff.
Looks great.
Yep.
I think the new Dust looks really cool from Fantasy Flight Games, too. That's,
Dust Warfare?
At least I saw the
Has
models.
Has anybody done
case.
A demo of Dust Warfare? I just watched it for a few minutes.
I want to try it.
Yeah.
Nobody.
Okay. The models look amazing.
Crickets on Dust Warfare.
Cricket. John, where are we with the sound effects?
Hey, I don't have those here today.
Cricket.
Boop, boop.
Cricket. Cricket.
All right, what about...
John's giving us the middle finger.
John's like, hey, more money, right?
No, he's giving us the money.
No, I think he was doing a cricket sound.
Is that what that was?
No, money.
He's saying more money for sounds. Right, he's on it.
Isn't that I want more wine with my cheese sound? The little violin? Oh, that's this.
Oh, yeah.
All right. What about board games? What's the hottest board game right now? everybody's got picked up. Anything new, hotness you didn't expect or something you're looking forward to?
They're all like, I didn't know we were going to get
quizzed. There's a quiz, right? See how hard this is? We make it look
Jeremy,
easy.
Jeremy, what's
look
that
this.
Big board game you picked up from Flying Frog?
Fortune and Glory.
Did you guys see that?
Who's
that
looks Fortune really Glory?
Cool. Yeah. That wasn't on the radar.
Components are hot. It looks really nice.
I got to get over there.
Who's played it yet?
Bueller?
No, it's played it yet. It looks like it's going to be a little bit of a time sink, but it looks like a fun time sink. Yeah, it looks like a good one. That's Flying Frog Productions.
Fun
right?
time sink.
Yep.
The best kind.
Yeah, good point.
That is right.
There's a question for you. If you're having fun, is it a time sink?
What about Deadwood?
He's
saying Deadwood over in the corner.
Deadwood?
Yeah.
Ooh, that looks cool. I saw
that
the dice
does look
for that.
Cool.
Who's played Deadwood? Who's seen it, first of all?
I've seen it.
Nice. Who's played it? Anyone played it yet? What'd you think? Quick and fun?
Yeah.
Do you feel like you're a cowboy?
Oh, yeah.
Now, are you in Deadwood, are you building a little town like Carson City, or are you actually killing people?
Well, both. You're moving around. You've got buildings that you can go into. When you go into a building, it causes different actions. You got cowboys. That
nice.
Dude, we got to check that out.
Yep.
Yeah, we have to go by there. That's
cool. Nice.
Awesome. See, that's where we learn things.
Yes. Yeah, this is really just for us to learn.
Yeah, I'm just making notes right here. Got to go check out. Last but not least, card games. You heard Blood Bowl for card games. Any other card games?
Elder
Food
Sign.
Fight. What's that?
Elder Sign.
Elder Sign.
Whoa. What's that? What's Elder Sign?
Cthulhu.
Arkham card game.
collectible, living card, Dominion style?
Just
self-contained.
Okay. Is it deck building?
No.
It's more of a dice game, you said?
Dice and cards.
So like Quarriors? Like Quarriors is Dominion with dice?
Oh, really?
Oh.
Yeah,
oh.
Cool.
Is that another FFG?
That sounds really cool.
Yeah.
Jesus, man. They're just all over that.
Yeah, they just exploded all over the place.
Yeah. Pushing a lot of like Silver Line.
John,
John Richards
in the back.
He's already got one. He's got his copy. Look at Upley.
You know those guys over at Game On? They've got their finger on the pulse. Well, it is the gaming capital of the world.
It is.
Indianapolis.
Now, before we go on to modeling.
Your city smells kind of a little bit, though, I've noticed. Wow. Have you guys noticed that when you go outside, there's like an odor? What is that, John? Diesel?
That's called gamers.
No, not the gamer
funk. It's not here year round.
Right.
Snap.
Nice. Give that man a prize. Give that man a book. All right.
You just dissed Boston.
You get a book.
Ah, nice.
Are you a traitor? Right there,
he got
man.
Handed Are You a Traitor? And it's the demo
we'll
open
get you
copy.
He wouldn't take that. Wow, look at that. That's sad.
For all the record, You Are the Traitor was just returned.
All right. How about modeling? So for modeling today, why don't we talk about what you've seen for... painting?
The Booth Babe
best
at
sculpt.
Food Fight.
What's the coolest
the sculptures you've seen around?
Coolest sculptures, either in the halls or actual models for games?
I'd say Sedition Wars at the Cool Mini or Not booth.
Sedition Wars?
Yes.
Cool.
Who's seen Sedition Wars? Cool?
Very
all right,
nice.
Cool.
I like the avatar of Seamus for Malifaux.
Yeah, the Malifaux avatar is pretty hot.
I got to see that.
Someone over there? Want to say that? Nope.
Anybody have big the statues that they put up all over the place? Favorite ones of those?
I'm a
giant warjack.
Oh, I'm
a giant warjack.
Big blue
over there.
Yeah. Yep, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say the dusk or the dust figs are they blew me away.
They are
the new dust, the six-legged thing.
Those giant walkers are
really
awesome.
Yeah.
Oh,
if you haven't seen those, go see those guys. Those are good.
Who thinks that's a game to watch now that it's got a new rule set coming out by Andy Chambers?
Me.
I think
that's
so too.
That's not a new rule set. That's a new game.
Yeah.
The other game still exists.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
Okay.
We don't
want to
kick anybody off.
What about anybody watched any painting contests yet or speed painting yet? Or is that still too early in the con? No? Do anything for anybody?
Yeah. All right. Check it out if you get time, though, because it's really funny.
Yeah.
They're very like.
It's fun to watch them heckle each other while they're speed painting.
Yeah, that is pretty cool.
Yeah. It could very well. Those guys are at least going for 20 minutes straight.
And last, we should go to other, I guess. What about, anybody done True Dungeon yet? A show of applause? So how is it? Who's done, by a show of applause, who's done the combat side of True Dungeon? All right. Who's done the puzzle side of True Dungeon? All right. Now, which is cooler, puzzle or combat? No one's done both.
How would you know? Who's done both?
Who's done both?
Cricket. We really should have sprung for the cricket sound effects.
We should have. So
I didn't know there was two sides. There's
now
two
who,
sides.
Of those people, who did it last year also? No.
Good. So that's good.
So everybody liked True Dungeon? Was it cool this year?
Yeah. All right.
John, which one are we doing?
No, that would be bad. Yeah. How many rooms
Combat?
Did you go through in Nightmare? Oh.
So last year no one was able to win. Who? Yeah, Will
yeah,
Wheaton won.
Will Wheaton won. Yeah.
This year.
Really?
Nice. Wow. So this year, who went actually won? Who beat the dungeon?
We won puzzle.
Nice.
Oh, cool.
Nice. All right, cool. Awesome.
Very good.
What about panels? Anybody in any panels yet or other events that aren't related to this? How was it?
Really good.
Cool.
Was that the one run by Wass Watson? 40K role-playing is what he said. Okay.
Yeah, he was supposed to come here, and he couldn't because
he doesn't love us anymore.
Boo is
That's right. Boo.
Wass Watson listens. It's not your chance to let him know how you feel that he didn't come here. Ready?
Boo.
Nice.
Just kidding, Ross.
Yeah.
He is doing the
best okay.
demos,
there right. you go. You've been okayed.
All right. And finally, for the other, what's been the cool? We had one cosplay. What's the coolest cosplay you've seen so far?
The D6G hockey jerseys.
Hey. Anything else? Inspector Gadget was cool. My favorite. Actually,
now explain Inspector Gadget. Don't just.
Oh, Nicole saw a really cool one.
Did anyone see? There was a little girl who was dressed up like a Dalek. She had like the little skirt on, and she had little things so she could shoot.
Oh, that
was my
awesome.
Favorite. I was going to mention the angel.
The crying angel and the little girl yes. Doctor Who going together were great.
That was awesome.
I like the robot one, which I thought was Halo, but you said no.
I think it's Halo.
I think it might be an offshoot of Halo, yeah.
Okay.
Little girl in
I
Halo
liked
armor.
It.
Hey, nice
Twilight, there you go.
Twilight, half-naked girl, someone showing
nice.
Us a Twilight girl.
That's so weird, gamers liking half-naked girls.
Who knew?
That's a very cool interesting conversation you must
That's
have.
Right. Is it pre-boiled or is it raw?
No, it's food for later.
Okay, fair.
Food for later.
Nice.
Not unlike the hump of a camel.
So is that Achievements?
That's Achievements.
That's Achievements.
Cool.
Yay!
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. Born to game.
Hello! And of course, if you're playing almost any kind of game known to man, the one thing you're going to want to visit eventually is Lone Wolf Development for aids in almost anything you're going to do in the gaming verse. So,
Craig, do you have access to a computer down in your bunker to be able to run Hero Lab?
I do have access to a hardened computer with Hero Lab and Army Builder on it. So there you go. Yeah,
sweet.
And speaking of Hero Lab, of course, Gen Con, we're just out of Gen Con, and of course everybody knows the big awards that are given out at Gen Con, the Ennies, and Hero Lab won a gold Enny at the con for best game aid or accessory.
Indeed.
Nice.
Indeed it did. That was very exciting.
Well deserved.
Well deserved indeed. And of course the Hero Lab name just keeps growing and growing with Shadowrun has now just been released for it, and the Pathfinder Ultimate Combat Data Package, and there's two more Pathfinder data. So they love Pathfinder. Now remember, Pathfinder was the huge winner last year of the Ennies,
yep.
mm-hmm. and I think it may have picked up a couple this year too.
It did.
So Pathfinder is
3.5.
Yeah.
And Pathfinder is huge, and their partnership with Lone Wolf is marked and growing. So you can expect Goblins of Galarion and Faiths of Balance to be released before the end of August. So the Pathfinder presence on Hero Lab is just big and getting bigger.
You know, I'm so glad you pronounced those names instead of me, because that would have been a mess.
Oh, pretty sure they were wrong.
Hey, you know what's cool, too, at Gen Con? I just have to throw this out there. We got to see a full demo of the new Realmworks.
Yes, we did.
And you have to see this product to understand it, because it was, you know, someone tells you, hey, you know, we're working on a piece of software that's going to make it easy for DMs to organize their campaigns. And you're like, yeah, whatever. It's called the Notepad. No. You need to check this out. It is fantastic. It's like the more you see of it, the more you're like, this needs to be on my machine now. So if you want to know more about Realmworks and all those other things going on right now, go on ahead on over to wolfslayer.com and check out what Lone Wolf Development is up to now. And now, what's in the news? With a shout-out, The Gaming Geek, the source for your board game and role-playing game needs at some of the most competitive prices on eBay. Currently stocking popular deck-building games like Dominion, Resident Evil, and the new Lord of the Rings Living Card Game, along with many other popular RPGs and board games. We've got a good supply of Alien Frontiers, Seven Wonders, and its Leaders expansion, along with Merchants and Marauders, Pirate Game. Find them all at store.ebay.com/the-gaming-geek. All right. It's time for the news. Boy, Wakeland, looking at all the bullets here, this looks like it might be a long one.
Yeah, but it's okay. Achievements game was really short. We got plenty of time, plenty of bandwidth.
You sure?
Oh, yeah, go for it. Don't worry about it.
All right. And a Russ's rant at the end here.
Yeah, no worries. Just keep going.
All right. Okay. Wakeland says we have time, so let's see what we can get in here. First up of the news, gamers doing good deeds, and you can help. There's a lot going on right now, and you can see lots of great examples of gamers getting into the Charity Act and helping others through games and other activities. First up, the folks at the Pulp Gamer Media Network have started something called CreativePlayProject.org. It's a great charity to help give games to youth clubs to get them into the exciting and creative thinking of board games. Good idea there. So head on over to CreativePlayProject.org to check out how you can help out there. Also, a friend of the D6 Generation, ExtraLife.org. It's time for Extra Life to pop up again on your radar. Extra Life happens every year in October, started by the great folks over at SarcasticGamer.com, that podcast over there. Extra Life is a charity that helps children's hospitals around the world, and basically it's a gaming marathon, 24 hours. This year it's on October 15th. It starts at 8 a.m., runs for 24 hours, primarily video games, but last year they expanded out to all other kinds of gaming as well, board games, card games. Doesn't really matter. Just play some games, get some pledges, and raise money for kids in hospitals. It's a great, great cause. And finally, speaking of kids in hospitals, our friends over the Dice Tower, Tom Vassell, has started a special charity in memorial of his son, Jack Vassell, over at jackvassell.org. That's JACKVASEL.org. You can go on over there and donate some money and help the Dice Tower folks. They've started a funding project to help any kind of gamers suffering personal hardship. Just sort of a way that the gaming community get together and help other gamers in need. So some great ways to get behind the charity of your choice. And it's always great to see gamers working together to help other people out in need. Good stuff. And speaking of game news, of course, it's GenCon this past weekend, and lots of news hitting the streets. Some of the highlights from the con this year. Right before the con, Fantasy Flight Games sort of got everybody excited with their big announcement that they have just received the Star Wars license for producing card games, miniature games, and role-playing games. No board games in that list, but role-playing games, card games, and mini-games, all pretty excited. And not only did they announce this, but then they actually demoed two of the first games in this Star Wars line at Gen Con. First was the X-Wing demo. Oh, it was awesome! Wakeland, did you get a chance to play it? It was great! I was flying around. I was like... It was great! It was just so cool! Easy, you want to use any English there so people can... Anyway, according to Wakeland, it's very much like Wings of War, but with a lot more depth. Same sort of mechanics, and the biggest thing was the Fantasy Flight dials they are now becoming famous for are in the game. You use the dials to dial in the maneuver you're going to use instead of the cards you might have found in Wings of War. It looks kind of neat. The pre-painted prototype models they had there are also very impressive. Also big news from Gen Con was Descent 2 was announced. This is the second edition of Descent. Announced in a couple different flavors. First, you can buy, eventually, sometime in 2012, they didn't give an exact date, of course, you'll be able to buy the new Descent starter set. It's actually a smaller box, not a giant coffin box anymore. Descent 2 will be $79.95. You'll get 8 heroes, 38 monsters, and 48 map tiles. And, of course, the usual pile of cards and tokens along with the rulebook. Now, this is a little smaller, but it's also more affordable than the current Descent. Also coming out, though, is the Descent Conversion Kit for only $24.95. And this little box will have all the cards and hero sheets you need to convert every Descent model and hero ever printed into the new rule set that includes promo heroes and promo monsters. So that means that if you're already a Descent player and have all the Descent stuff, no worries, for $25, you'll be back in the hunt with the brand new rule set. The other big news about this is the campaign system is now embedded in the core rules of the system. Apparently, the target design requirements here for this, they were trying to get shorter quests, and they've added defense dice to try to streamline and reduce the math involved when trying to figure out your surges and other activities. So we'll see what happens with that. Always exciting to see Descent go on there and see what's going on with that. Also, two other kind of big news from the floor there. Rex, the game Rex, R-E-X, was announced. Now, this may seem like, oh, great, another game, who knows what it is, but actually, according to the little card put in the case by Fantasy Flight, and from reports from the Flight Report, this is actually a re-theming of the classic game Dune from the 80s. So if you're a fan of the old-school Dune game, it's back in the form of Rex with a TI theme coming out next year as well. And, of course, there was Dust Warfare being demoed heavily, which is a new miniature combat system for Dust. Those are just prototype rules. They're still working through it, but it would look pretty impressive. Other announcements recently. WizKids just announced a Harry Potter Clicks game. It's a Harry Potter board game called the Hogwarts House Cup Challenge, which allows 2 to 4 players to play as Harry, Ron, Hermione, and Neville. Neville, really? Who wants to be Neville? As they do their quest to win the House Cup for Gryffindor. Players move the characters around the board, encountering adventure cards, and increasing their knowledge, skill, and honor. As the characters' abilities grow, they face harder challenges based on the Harry Potter films from Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone through Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. I guess they didn't want to get it too dark for the youngsters. Players who complete the different adventures will earn victory points to reward themselves for the Gryffindor, and when Gryffindor reach 500 points, the player with the most points wins the game! That sounds pretty cool. I guess there's going to be clicks involved there, so if you're a Harry Potter fan, keep an eye out on that. Okay, and now it's time. Every once in a while, Wakeland likes to get his pull up his little chair here and do a little Russ's rant. Are you ready for this, Wakeland? Oh, I'm ready. Let me get to the mic. Here we go. Okay. All right. Thank you, news guy. So now it's time for Russ's rant. So I don't often get to chat with our listeners here one-on-one and bare my soul like Raef and Craig do here on the Hollywood Minute and the Do You Ever Notice, but I thought it might be a good time to do that since I got to say hi to so many of you at Gen Con, and because something very kind of rant-worthy did occur there, and I wanted to share it with you, partly for the catharsis, but also because I'd love to hear your thoughts on the topic as well. And before I get into all that, let me talk about some of the highlights from Gen Con. Gen Con 2011 this year was fantastic, but not really because of the vendor hall or the great demos or the new games, which of course were all cool. But it was really fantastic for me because I got to spend so much time with the new friends and old friends that I've made because we, Craig, Raef, and I, spend so much time doing this podcast. It really does recharge my enthusiasm for gaming in general, as well as my dedication to the show every time we go to Gen Con. It's just fun to see you guys and hear what you're up to and see all the new games and get everything pumped, and it makes me really, really excited about what we do. For example, on Wednesday, we were treated to a really awesome barbecue by John Richard and Cody at the John Richard Estate there, the Game On facilities. It was really nice to meet their whole family. They made us feel part of the family immediately. We got to hang out with other podcast hosts from the Dice Tower, from Game On, from Ludology, from Myriad Presentations. And we got to play a test game, another new game from the Engelstein Father and Son Design teams. That was really cool. But none of that would have gotten to happen if we didn't do our D6G episodes and work so hard on the podcast like we do. Nor would three guys from Iowa have invited me, a total stranger to these guys, to play a game of Tannhauser with them. Thanks to Steve, Jonathan, and Josh, who made me feel as if I was part of their regular gaming crew. They took the time to refresh the rules for me, and they even waited patiently when I ripped open my brand new samurai guys that I got at the Fantasy Flight booth that day and tried them out in the game. And despite being trounced, I had a great time. I was really flattered that they planned one of their big part of the Gen Con schedule all around me. It was really nice of them. So thanks, guys. That was really one of my highlights for the whole weekend. That was awesome. And the podcast also allowed us to run our second annual Play by Mob event, which freaked me out a little bit when I realized that long line clogging up the hallway waiting to see the event was for us. I was like, holy mackerel, what's that line there? It's our event. Thanks again to John Richard for Game On and Game Salute and the excellent Gen Con staff. The whole event went without a hitch, and we gave away a lot of Black Library books. We gave away a lot of out-of-the-box games, and everybody who attended was a great sport and played right along, and it was a really, really good time. And again, another one of those magic Gen Con moments. And after the Play by Mob, the event I was looking forward to most was to take place that Saturday night. Thanks again to the show, we had become very friendly over the years with Ross Watson of Fantasy Flight Games, as many of you know. And he's the man, of course, behind the Warhammer 40,000 RPGs. And Ross had agreed to play a single session of Deathwatch RPG with us and a few of our friends. We were also going to record the session for publication as a multi-part series in the Lost Chapter, so I was really excited about that as well. And as you can imagine, I was just thrilled with this prospect. I mean, how many times do you get to sit down and play a great game with one of the great designers of the game? But for me, even more than that, it was that Games Workshop games like Warhammer 40,000 are so fun because of the idea that you can create a character with an army and play that games and watch the story unfold. I have one such character called Michael, an Ultramarine librarian who I created over 15 years ago. And he's been involved in every single Imperial army I ever fielded. I've written pages and pages of fiction and battle reports about him and all of his war gear combinations. In fact, when the idea for Deathwatch was first introduced by Games Workshop, and it was something you use in Warhammer 40,000, I converted Michael, ripped off his old shoulder pad, put a new shoulder pad on there, and wrote even more material explaining all of Michael's cool Deathwatch exploits. And as regular listeners know, I don't really get to play 40K much anymore, but I still love the background. The characters I created, like Michael, still hold a very special place in my gamer heart. And when the Deathwatch RPG came along, I was just thrilled. Now I could continue the adventures of Michael with all the depth and background only an RPG could provide. And I did just that back when Craig ran his Deathwatch game last year. And it was everything I'd hoped it'd be. It was so fantastic. I was really happy with how I could bring Michael to life in a role-playing game. So back to Gen Con. So I couldn't wait to play Michael the Librarian with Ross and explain how awesome it was that this RPG he helped create let me revive and expand upon a beloved character that I created so long ago. In my head, I'd imagine Ross asking me things like, "Hey, Russ, why does your Ultramarine Librarian have wings on his jump pack?" And I'd get to explain to him that, "Well, Ross, back in 1996, when playing against Elder this one time, I got this great idea." But unfortunately, it did not really go as I imagined. When I got to the play session, it turned out that one of my local friends, let's call him Bob, decided that he wanted to play the Librarian, air quotes, and had already removed him from the folder. What? Michael was my character. I'd spent hours last year just setting him up. I was stunned and didn't know exactly what to say. But Michael's my character, I said. We're mixing it up, said Bob. Of course, Ross was already at the table, and we were already getting ready to record, and Craig had worked very hard in trying to get everything set up just so as the GM, and I didn't really want to be that guy and make a big scene right there, so I kind of looked through the remaining characters. Two of them belonged to other guys that I knew were going to be playing tonight, so I didn't want to do to them what Bob had just done to me. So I looked, and I found Rafe's Space Wolf character that he had played in our last session. Now, I knew Rafe had a very special Inquisitor just rolled up for tonight, so I knew also that no one would miss the Space Wolf, so I decided to play him. So, with my dream of being able to roleplay all the thought and history of Michael with Ross kind of snatched away, I tried to be a good sport and soldier on. Sadly, it got worse. turned out that the Space Wolf character I decided to play had never really been completed. He had not gone through the skill point assignments, and the only weapon he had been given was a heavy bolter. Well, not even a heavy bolter, just a bolter. Just a regular bolter. Throughout the game, the party's leader, Bob, of course it was Bob because he was the awesome Ultramarine Librarian, remember, so everybody picked him to be the leader, decided to be funny if he assigned the Space Wolf tasks that he wasn't really suited for, and kind of always ensured, I'm not really sure why, that my character, the Space Wolf, was always in the back of the line or farthest from the fighting. And when, of course, Ross did finally ask about the wings in the Librarian model, just as I imagined he would, I wasn't in any position to say anything in character or explain the history of Michael, because at this point, I was fuming mad at Bob, to be honest with you, and trying not to lose my cool and ruin the event. Why was I so mad? It's only a game, right? I mean, I asked myself this question later. What was I so upset about? Well, Craig had made a point in a Deavidus a while ago that fear can make you angry. But it turns out that the number one reason for anger is when you feel hurt. And I realized that I was really deeply hurt that Bob, a longtime friend of mine, would do this to me. He knows how hard I work on the show. He knows that the opportunity came because of our hard work on the show. And he knew that Michael, a.k.a. the Librarian to Bob, was my character as he played with us last time. He was right there with me when I made Michael. So Bob is occasionally kind of a smart-arse guy, you know, but still, this seemed a little over the line for him. Of course, then, as the game continued, I got even more frustrated with myself for letting my anger with Bob taint what was clearly an awesome RPG event going on right there in front of me. Craig ran a tight, interesting adventure with great role-playing and characters. Ross did a fantastic Scottish accent that I mean, try not to crack up every time he did it. And I learned a great deal about some of the more subtler Deathwatch mechanics right there from the master, the guy who wrote the book. Not to mention that we have a recording the first ever live RPG session for the Lost Chapters. That was pretty cool, too. So, long story short, I let my anger with Bob taint one of the events I was most looking forward to at Gen Con. Could this have been avoided? I'd love to hear what your thoughts are on it, but Here's my rant, finally. As if enough of that stuff over there wasn't ranting already. Here's my rant on how to prevent such an issue in the future. Here we go. So when playing an RPG, number one, set the expectations. Ross said this himself, actually, on a Lost Chapter guest appearance he did once with us. He said, when you're playing a role-playing game, make sure you set the expectations between your players and the GM. If we were going to play random characters, just picked out of a pile, then we should have all known that, and I would have had these crazy ideas that I'd get to play the character I made last year and actually be able to share him with Ross. Also remember that an RPG is a group experience. Try not to put your quest for the fun ahead of the other players or their experience. If you're the party leader for whatever reason, because you got the guy with the best stats or you just kind of wanted to be and no one else cared, try to make sure that the assignments you give everybody is something they characters can do and excel at so they can have fun too. And also, the pre-generated characters should be roughly equal. If you're going to do pre-generated characters and not let the players create their own people, make sure all the characters are relatively balanced. No one wants to be stuck with a bland vanilla character if someone else has got this cool, seriously kick but awesome hero. And never, ever should someone be stuck with an unfinished character. That just stinks. And last, but certainly not least, never touch another man's character. That's right up there with touching his dice. And you just don't do that. Well, what do you think, Wakelin? You feeling better? Oh, it's like a weight lifted from my chest. Really? Yeah, I think there might be something to this catharsis thing. I'm not sure, but yeah, and if anybody has any opinions, want to let me know what they thought, what I could have done differently, did I overreact, did I freak out, whatever, let me know. I'd love to hear some of your gaming events. Did anything disappoint you? Maybe the whole catharsis thing will help us feel better. So send email to russ at the d6generation.com. There you go. And that's What's in the News.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. Born to game.
Now it's time for BattleFoam.com.
Protecting your miniatures so you don't have to.
Oh, I thought Craig got attacked by a dog there.
I did too. I thought he was like, what the hell right now?
Okay.
His machine gun exploded.
I know, right?
Craig is in a bunker tonight. You notice?
I am in a bunker.
Yeah, he's in some kind of strange bunker.
Disclosed location.
Deep in the hall.
Completely surrounded by foam. Made by BattleFoam.
Well, Romeo had an awesome presence they had an awesome presence at GenCon. It was fantastic.
Yes, they did.
And they were selling foam like crazy. It was
awesome. They brought enough foam theoretically so that they could supply GenCon and Adepticon next year, and that was their big plan.
Yeah.
So they would ship it to GenCon, and then they would just finish shipping it over to Chicago, and they don't have enough.
Right.
They sold so much that they're going to have to redo it for Adepticon next year.
Right. Wow. Well, that's not really a surprise because Gen Con was huge this year.
Huge.
But the other thing that was huge is they have a big announcement this very week. They just started starting that's this right. up. It's called the remember this? It's called the Pac-Go.
Pac-Go. It sounds like an Asian
tile game.
Yeah.
Yeah, they actually...
I will be playing Pac-Go.
Yeah, they actually announced it back at...
And I will be eating Pad Thai.
Actually, it sounds like a German artillery gun instead of a Pac-40. It's a Pac-Go.
Well, I guess it's all where you're coming from.
They announced it at Salute last year in UK, but it looks awesome. Basically, I guess a lot of the folks in Europe, especially in UK, they get around a lot on bikes and motorcycles.
Yes, they do. On scooters.
Right, scooters. And how are you going to carry a giant battle foam bag, as awesome as it is, on a scooter? So the Pac-Go's idea is it's a backpack. Now, I know what you're saying. You're saying, but Russ, I saw battle foam back in the day. They have those giant backpacks. This thing is designed to actually fit on your back, and it doesn't look like a refrigerator on your back.
It doesn't look like a mini fridge on your back.
No, it's a
Romeo's own words.
Yeah, it's a black backpack. It looks very nice. It does look a little square because it's got a whole miniatures, but it doesn't look like this giant thing on your back.
You know what it looks like? It looks like when a kid is going to school and he's got all his books in his backpack.
Right, right. And it's only in black, but that's to help it blend in so it doesn't look like a strange guy with a bright green, you know, military-colored thing on his back heading to the airport. And what's cool about it, too, is it uses the same tray size as all the other pack bag systems.
Oh, cool.
The 720s, the 432s, the 1520 XLs. All those guys, if you've got trays for those already, you can just pick up the Pac-Go and pop your same trays in there.
Yep.
It's pretty deep. It holds 9 inches of foam. So that's plenty of foam for most good-sized armies. But I thought it was really cool as a tech guy, okay? Romeo didn't let us down in the pocket. So the middle of the bag is hard, just like other battle foam bags.
Right.
But the exterior backside, the part that would face away from you, is a little soft, and there's a smaller front pocket and then a larger back back pocket. The front pocket is exactly the size of an iPad. It slides right in there. So if you're one of those guys now like me, you're just starting to put these PDF files in your iPad, slide it right in there. You got all your rules, your FAQs, whatever you need. If you don't have an iPad, no problem. It's a perfect size for as many rule books, everything else you're going to throw in there. And then there's a larger front pocket. Let's say you're like, I ain't no fanboy of Apple, Wakelin. I use a real laptop. No problem, because the secondary pocket is exactly the size of a full-size laptop. Slide that right in there, throw your game books in the front, you're good to go. So you got your tech and your miniatures. You're ready to rock as the hot, high-tech gamer that you are.
Basically, when I was looking at it, I'm like, oh, how many more packs can there be, you know, Romeo? I mean, I get it. There's different sizes. But sure enough, he's freaking done it again. I look at it, I'm like, hey, that's really innovative.
And this is the kind of service they provide, right? So they got feedback on their original, you know, fridge-sized backpack. And they would gamers would say that it held so many models, it would the lower edge of it would cut into your back because it was weighing down and cutting into your back. So the new Paco, it's, A, it's smaller, so it's going to be a little lighter. But B, they got this special piece of I don't know, it's a material that snaps off and folds around under your back and makes a little pillow there. So the back, your back is not cut against the edge of the backpack. Really smart stuff. If you want to see more about this amazing little, really innovative design, I think, go on over to battlefoam.com and search out the Pack Go. And on that webpage, just scroll down to the bottom. You see a little video. Watch it, check it out, and Romy will tell you all the details.
There you go.
That's right. That's right, Kai. It's battlefoam.com.
His board game collection is expanding faster than the universe. His blood smells like paint. He's a fluff gamer, not a power gamer. But he's also a power gamer, so don't get any ideas. He once lost a game just to see how it feels. He's the most interesting gamer in the world.
I don't always listen to gaming podcasts, but when I do, I prefer the D6 generation.
How many of you did Play by Mob last year? Couple people? Okay, I didn't. Right. I was
much,
busy.
That's kind of scary. Not much repeat business on Play by Mob, Craig.
Okay. Just saying. So what we're going to do is the whole mob of you are going to be playing Deathwatch with us today. Yeah. Okay? We're going to divide you. What is it?
Is there going to be mudslides?
There won't be any mudslides today, but there may be mudslides tomorrow night.
Alabama.
Wrong game. That would be Dark Heresy. Okay, so basically what's going to happen is we're going to divide you up into quarters. Our visual aids fell apart, so there's no really cool posters for you to identify with. Apologize. I think you'll be fine. So what we'll do is to get you set up. Okay, so you guys forward, you're one. You guys back, you're one. And you guys, you guys back, you're one. And you guys forward, you're one.
So we're all number one.
Okay, you're all number one. You each play a space marine. Everybody know what a space marine is? Anybody not know? Okay, you are genetically enhanced superior superhumans in enormous suits of power armor. This is why Raef hates the game. Okay, because you're almost impossible to kill. You've got weapons that are actually small missile launchers that rapid fire. Okay, little rockets that explode when they hit their targets. And you're going to be basically going on a little adventure that's going to have several different objectives. And you're working for an organization called the Inquisition. The Inquisition does what Inquisitions do, okay? They go and they root out problems and they kill people and they tell people what to do and they investigate. We're not so much in the investigation branch, the Death Watch. We're more into the investigation's been done, now let's go kill stuff. Okay? So the way we'll work this out is you guys are going to be Belial the Devastator Marine. Okay? So you've got a giant heavy bolter.
Yay!
Okay, Belial! Okay, you guys are going to be Michael the Librarian. Okay, there you go, Ultramarine Librarian. So you guys have a heavy bolter and a pistol in case that goes horribly wrong. You guys have a pistol, a force sword, think lightsaber, basically, force weapon, okay, and you have a jump pack. So you can jump all over the place if you want. Raef has to go to the bathroom, that's awesome. Okay.
Exactly where he's running.
You guys are going to be Rothgar, the Space Wolf Tactical Marine, okay, also known as the Grey Hunter. And you guys are going to be Andy the Tech Marine. he's not even here to enjoy that.
I'm
but
glad you didn't let them pick your names.
No. They're gonna we're gonna go with the fluff. Okay. So now what you need to do is for a second, I want everybody to think about what you want your thing to be. You're going to be performing some very small, either a chant or some sort of physical, like clap clap pattern or feet on the ground tapping. Okay, that's how we're going to judge how successful you are in any skill test that you have to do. Okay, so take a moment and discuss amongst yourselves.
Right, the better you do.
You might want to tighten up your seating arrangements.
Right.
Oh, Tech Marine, I like it. There you go. Okay. This is what I was going to do ahead of time.
Blood Angel, are you guys ready, Blood Angel? You guys ready? All right, so you guys ready? Let's hear the Blood Angels. I like it.
Are they blood angels? No, they're dark angels. Dark angels. What are you doing? Oh, very nice. Okay, I like it. Michael, ready? One, two, three. Oh, very nice. The flailing with the four sword. Okay, ready? Rothgar. One, two, three. I like it. Okay, ready? And Andy, ready? One, two, three.
100, 100.
Nice, okay. All right. Okay, ready? So here we go. You are in the middle of the watch station. It is a massive space station floating in space. Where else would you expect it to float? Okay. And you're in the training room. So this is what you do when you're not on missions. You guys are hacking away at these massive servitors that used to be living people, and, you know, they cleaned the wrong computer screen or something, and so their brains were plucked out and put into a little machine that people fight until they blow it up. Okay? So this is going to be a practice to see how you all work together. You're all working together, fighting these things. Ready? Hack, slash, parry, dodge. When I point at you, you say your word. Hack, slash, parry, dodge. Ready? This one's going to be easy.
Hack, slash, parry, dodge. Hack, slash, parry, dodge. Parry, hack, dodge, slash, hack, dodge, parry, slash, hack, dodge, parry, slash, hack, slash, dodge, parry, slash, hack, parry, dodge, parry.
Okay, so you're really exhausted. You're almost as tired as I am. Okay, you get summoned to the central area by the Inquisitor. This is, by the way, for those of you who listen to Lost Chapters, the Return to Belial Secundus campaign. Okay, so you remember what happened there. Okay. I can tell some of you do. All right. So you get summoned to the Inquisitor, who's in charge of the entire watch station. He is not pleased. He doesn't like you. He thinks the Death Watch is a mistake. What's that? Hack! That didn't work. And then they killed the Inquisitor. I think you're looking for Black Crusade, sir. Okay. So, here's the problem. We've lost touch with Belial Secundus. It's a very important agricultural planet in this sector that we're in charge of. We need to go find out what's gone wrong in Belial Secundus. Okay? The astropathic contact, that's the psychers that can connect each other psychically, and that's the only way you can communicate faster than light, all of a sudden gone silent. We can't communicate with the planet. What's that? Nuke them? No, mudslide. It was a mudslide. What's
that?
They did, actually. Actually, no, it came. The communication stopped right after the announcement that Jersey Shore is going to Italy. I don't know. The governor of the planet, Guido, may have done it on his own. Okay, Badiatis is the governor, and we're kind of shaky on whether or not he's... Anybody, any fans of the Spartacus show here? Okay, good. So that's where half the names came from. Okay, so give me a... We'll just keep giving you books. It makes our job easier. Okay, so here's the problem. We need to know why the astropathic contact suddenly cut off. And we're going to bring a new astropath to this planet and try to install him there so we can get contact with the planet again. We're going to find out what the heck's up with Battiatus. Okay, and by the way, there's a couple hundred million credits that have gone missing that this planet was supposed to be sending in for taxes, and we don't know what's gone with that either. Okay, so this Inquisitor, who doesn't like you, is going to send you, and hopefully you're going to mess it up, it's not going to work, and he'll be proven that the Death Watch is a bad idea, and you guys will have failed not only yourselves and your multiple different chapters. Space Marines all come from different chapters, basically unified armies that stand alone, and then they fight together sometimes, but it's like an entire world that you come from. So you guys are very medieval, you wear robes a lot. You guys are very sort of Greek. You guys are wolfy and Viking-like, and you guys are actually iron hands, so you love chopping pieces of yourselves off and replacing it with mechanical parts. As far as an ethnic stereotype, I'm not sure. You go with whatever you want. Okay? So you jump in your spaceship, you're going to go to Belial Secundus. As you arrive, there's no contact, there's nothing, the planet is quiet, nothing's going on, who knows what's wrong, your sensors can't detect it, there's life forms everywhere because it's a giant farm planet, so you can't really figure out what's going on. So as you fly over in the high orbital, you're looking down, you're trying to figure out where can we land. There's the capital city, you could land there. There is the warehouse district, you can land there, and there's a processing area, you can land there. Or you can land in the countryside, it's totally up to you. Okay, so you guys now have to decide. We're going to do this test, and then whichever group wins, you'll decide where we're going to land. So ready, you want to do your thing? One, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three. They may win just because I'm a Space Wolf fan. 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0.
You were all pretty good. Where do you guys want to land? In the capital? Sure, what the heck? Okay. You're Space Marines. There's absolutely no need for you whatsoever to sort of sneak in. So your spaceship's coming in. Does anybody want to do anything special as the spaceship approaches, as your shuttle approaches the capital city? Buzz the tower. Negative Ghost Rider, the pattern is full. Okay. So you buzz the tower, nothing. Okay, there's a giant palace in the middle. That's where the governor lives. No sign of anybody moving around. You crash. You don't really crash, but you just storm right in there. It's a storm raven. You land. The flagstones shatter because you're like, we're Space Marines. What do we care? Okay, you stomp out. There's the big palace in front of you. What's that? Not yet. There will be, though. Okay, that's good, though. See, situational awareness. You always need to know what's going on, especially the heavy bolter guy. Okay, so you've got the palace in front of you. You're in a big square, not unlike Monument Circle over here. Okay, you start walking in. You're looking around. Of course, we're streamlining this whole thing. So I'm trying to, okay, now you check in your sensors. You don't see anything. Okay. Okay, there's a bunch of people in the palace, and there isn't anybody else around, although you guys saw one guy kind of like hanging out on the top of a building overlooking the circle, and you're like, check him out later. Okay, so you're going into the palace. There's nobody. The halls are ruined. They're empty. It's like everybody left all of a sudden. There's no sign of violence whatsoever, but who knows what's going on. Okay, you slowly make your way into the, if anybody listened to the show, you use your jump packs inside, which is a bad idea, you fail your check, you're flying all over the place with your jump pack, it's great fun. Okay, you actually miss the balcony, you fall off, great. Okay, you finally get into the throne room, and there he is, there's Battiatus, and he's sitting there. Okay, perception check, ready, go.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0.
Okay, there's something weird about this guy. Okay, he's shifty. He's weird. He's twitchy. Okay, what's that? He does have beady little eyes. What are you saying? I have beady? Okay. Okay, ready? Heavy bolter guy, though. Ready? 1, 2, 3, go. Okay, you're the guy in the back. You've got this massive heavy bolter, and all of a sudden you notice there's like guys slowly infiltrating in behind the governor. Okay, pretty soon there's over 40 guardsmen. These are like National Guard guys. Their equipment's sort of second rate. They don't have any armor, but there's 40 of them between you and the governor. Okay? How are we going to deal with this? Grenade. You can do that. Anybody else have an idea? You have a heavy bolter? Okay. Negotiate? Ready? Okay, ready? Here's your roll to hit. One, two, three, go. Okay, what's the space wolf doing? Okay, the space wolf has failed his perception check. And he's like, verily, forsooth, there must be someone here to fight.
That's the librarian. Reading a book.
I'm running this. He's reading a book. Ready? What are you guys doing? Anybody? You're jumping into combat. I like it. Hopefully you'll get there after the heavy bolter shells. And the tech marine. Throwing grenades. Okay, you can do both. Okay, because you're a tech marine. So you're throwing grenades and you're going full auto on your bolter. Okay, ready? Heavy bolter, go. And you're jumping into combat. We'll wait for a second. Okay, the grenades and the bolter.
100, 100.
Okay, and you guys are like, day what? Okay, and so let's see. Okay, there goes the heavy bolter. Awesome shooting. Okay, there goes the bolter, and there goes the grenade. So this is Death Watch, so you're taking out magnitude at a time. So basically, you guys have just taken out 8 magnitude. There's only 22 magnitude left, which is still a giant mob. Okay, and then you guys are like, with a grenade. Boom! That takes out a bunch of guys, too. There's only like 15 magnitude left. When Michael comes soaring in with his bolter, with his bolt pistol and his sword ready. 1, 2, 3.
Vroom, vroom, vroom.
Oh, and misses. That was kind of lame. In fact, it's very, very smooth marble. You surf right through the crowd. Okay, you take a hit on your way through, not because they're very good with their guns, but because they're trying to get out of your way. One guy hits you by accident. Ugh, I don't know, but bang, right off your armor. And you guys are like, what is going on? Okay, so now it's their turn to attack.
Ready?
It's up to you. What are you going to do? You got something to do? The two of you?
Oh, yeah.
You guys are the bad guys. Three of you.
We're going to rapid fire our las guns.
Okay, rapid firing las guns as a mob of 15 magnitude.
Mm-hmm. Right. This is how rapid fire sounds. Wrong!
The three of you together. 1, 2, 3.
Wrong!
Nice! Okay, they're las guns. They suck, but boy, there's 15 magnitude of them, and one of them is really, really mean. Okay? The way that the game system works, they can only hit each character once. Unless they've got special abilities, which these guys don't, they're weedy. So each one of you takes a hit. I'm going to let you take an armor save right now by doing your save. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Bing! Right off your armor. Ready? Go. Oh.
Yeah, Michael needs work.
Take a couple. It goes in. You guys, I don't know. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0. 1, 0, 0.
Oh, you laugh. Oh, the lasers glance off. Okay, ready, guys? Okay. I'm a space wolf at heart, and you guys are killing me. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
That's pretty good.
Nice. Okay, Michael, who is, by the way, the leader of the squad, not doing so well. Okay, so now it's your turn to attack. There's still areas of the mob you could get, even though Michael is now sort of in the middle of them. Okay, what are you guys doing?
Firing.
Okay, what you guys?
Give that man a book. You want it?
You're attacking Michael. Oh, attaching? What does that mean? I don't know what that means. I'm with flanking bonus. Okay, anyway, you're going to help Michael. You can do that. The tech marine, by the way, just so you have an idea, has a massive servo arm coming off of his power pack of his armor. So he's going to go in there. You can actually attack with both hands and the servo arms just punching stuff. Okay, there you go. You're going to try to rescue him. I like it. Okay. And what is the space wolf doing? I can't hear. Oh, you're going to try to get the governor out of the middle of the whole pot. Okay, that's going to take a serious check. Okay, we'll get to you last, though. We're going to keep the drama going. Okay, ready? Heavy bolter goes! Pretty decent shot. Not as good as last time. 15 magnitude goes down to about 12. Okay, we'll get you in a second. You're going to run. Actually, these two have very difficult tasks to perform. So, Michael, you're in the middle of the mob now. You get up, you shake it off, okay? You're surrounded. Ready? One, two, three, go.
I don't know if it's a battle cry.
I think your battle cry may need a little... You might want to think about it.
Change your stance. Change your stance.
Updating the battle cry. What's that? Yes. Okay, well, you could do that. Okay. I also would recommend, however, maybe a little more dramatic battle cry that vroom, vroom, vroom is... Seems to be causing
switch out
problems.
Your dice.
Switch out your dice. Okay. All right. So ready? Michael's in there. Maybe there's blood on your visor or something. He's flailing around with his storm power sword.
Work together. I think
okay. These guys are working together.
Yeah.
Okay. So you two are coming in together. Okay. This is going to be tough. It's going to be very high. You need several levels of success for this to work. Okay. Working together. I need the ooh and the 100 blah, blah, blah together. Ready? One, two, three, go.
That's pretty good. That was good. That was good.
I think there's a mentally deficient wolf in the pack.
Wow.
That's right.
There's one in every pack. Okay. So, yes, okay, the space wolf. And the Iron Hands run in. They're punching guys left and right. The servo arm goes in. Michael, who doesn't know this was happening, gets plucked out of the combat, flying through the air. What's going on? Okay. He's like, we're going to be charitable. He does have blood all over his visor. He's like, I don't know what's going on. The Space Wolf goes in, and because you're a Space Wolf, you've clamped down your bolter onto the mag lock on your hip, and you just smash that governor in the face. Ready? One, two, three. Okay, bad news, you're wearing power armor. Okay, Badiatis is not that robust a guy to start with. At the very least, you've shattered his jaw. He's unconscious, though. He could be dead. Who knows? You didn't bring a... no apothecary.
Very space wolfy.
He's very space wolfy. I'll show you for making me stand and do nothing for a turn. Okay, so now you're holding him up. He's unconscious. Shake him a little bit. That's what you do to your puppies. They're fine. Okay. So now it's the attack of the... Okay, ready? I need you guys to... Now you've taken a lot of hits. You may actually run away. Ready? One, two, three.
Run!
Okay. This is what happens.
Some tough cards been up here.
There's 12 magnitude left, which is still like 30 guys. 29 of them. Look at the governor, who they're convinced is dead. Drop their last guns and run. And one guy.
That's right.
Is going. Okay. Standing alone. Shoot him. Heavy bolter.
Oh.
Psyker shot. Give him to the librarian. He's the guy who shot you. Okay. Throw the librarian at him. Okay, ready? Here we go. You're shooting. You're going to use a psychic power. You're still holding Michael up. So your psychic power is being used like this as you're held up by your jump pack. And you guys have the governor, so I'm going to say you kind of need to... Well, he's probably dead, so it doesn't really matter. Okay, ready? One, two, three. And one, two, three.
There we go.
Nice, there you go. Okay, and you guys are still, like, giving him a braced position from which to... Okay, so it's a... Okay, I need both at the same time to tell exactly what's going on. Ready? One, two, three. Okay, 8 or 9 giant shells hit this one guy all at the same time. Any one of which would have put a hole in him that you could put your fist through before it explodes. Okay? However, the first one does explode, removing him right from the neck down to above the hips, as his head, looking very surprised, that expression right there, starts to back pinwheel, and his legs start to fall forward. All the other shells go sailing through and blow up against the wall. Almost at the same time, but not quite, because the head is still sort of spinning. This super psychic power strikes the head, explodes it, not unlike, you know, think True Blood, the TV show, when a vampire gets staked. So there's blood everywhere, way more than could have possibly be contained in a single head. Okay, so boom! Now we need to take... What's that?
Give it man a book!
Unless it's not the
Wow.
Wow.
Let's see how this works.
Wow. That is awesome how that little local joke has now made it across the globe. Okay. So let's take stock. There's blood everywhere. There's dead guardsmen everywhere. There's this little splash where that head used to be with that much blood in it. Okay. Now, the governor, he's sort of coming to. Okay, he's not dead.
He's going to talk like this for the rest of the afternoon.
Okay, so what do you need? What are you going to do? We need to find out where the astropath is and why. What's going on this planet? Because generally, Imperial Guardsmen do not attack Space Marines. It's very odd. Okay? Eat his brains. Again, Black Crusade is the game for you.
I've got enough module, damn it.
Oh, that's true. You could find... He needs a book.
Another one, give it.
Okay, the Space Marines do have an organ that gets implanted before puberty that when it develops, which it does in about 50% of Space Marines, allows them to eat the flesh of something and process the knowledge that creature had right before it died, which it's going to die now. So poor body on it, okay,
wow.
Gets opened like, I don't know, a little lunchbox. He does, in fact, eat the brains. Okay, you're getting flashes. There's something in the basement. Okay, who knows what it is, but it's monstrous. It's evil. There's some sort of alien presence in the basement. Okay. Also, there's something really bad over on the other side of these mountains where where the warehouse district was. Okay, and the processing plant is red herring. There's nothing there. Okay, good job. You ate the brains. Yes. Okay, ready? Do you want your jump pack checked?
I'll take any questions
later. Oh,
nice! I like that! Give the man a book.
Oh, insubordination will not be tolerated.
Nice.
Oh, that's awesome, because now you didn't get your jump pack checked.
Now you got to do opposing checks, right?
There you go. Oh, yeah, okay, we'll do opposing checks. Ready?
Same time.
First, you guys. One, two, three. And one, two, three.
1-0-0, 1-0-0.
Wow. That's tight.
Wow, that's pretty
that's
good.
Tough.
Okay. How dare you question? Okay. And you're still holding the dead, headless governor.
No, we're holding him.
Oh, holding him. That's shake him a little bit. Shake him. Right. Okay. So yeah, okay. Ready? Now here's your skill check to try to fix it. 1-2-3.
1-0-0, 1-0-0.
Were they successful? I guess we won't know until you use your jump back again. Okay, so there's something in the basement, which is probably where the astropath was, and there's something really bad going on over in the warehouse district, and there's a giant train that goes back and forth underground to get there. What do we want to do? Basement. Raise your hand if you want. Clap if you want basement.
That sounds definitive.
Clap if you want warehouse.
Give that girl a look.
I want to go to the basement.
What about the train?
Nice. Okay, it is warehouse 14.
What about the train?
That would be how you get to the basement. I mean, to the warehouse district.
I think they have to sing the song to get there. Come on, ride the train.
Thank you.
They got to do that to get there, Craig.
Eventually. We'll go there. Okay. So you're going down into the basement. I need to know who's in what's the order of
march? Order.
Heavy Bolter's in the lead.
Wow.
Wow, okay. The Space Wolf has better senses. He's good at shooting. He's good at hand-to-hand.
Let's not judge the players.
Put him in the back. And the Heavy Bolter guy who's really slow. Okay, nice. I like it. Okay. After the Heavy Bolter guy?
Yeah.
Cricket. Okay, the Tech Marine. That's good. Okay. Going around. Okay, you do have a shoulder. No, that's an apothecary with the shoulder lamp. You probably have a lamp somewhere, though. You've got everything. Yeah. Okay, you got one. What about you two? Who's in the back? You're in the back. Fearless leader, Michael. Paving the way, just in case we have to run. That's true.
Here's a commissary.
Okay, so you go down, it's darker. All of a sudden, you're starting to see those signs of violence that you would expect. If something bad had happened, there's dead guys everywhere. There's blood splashed on the walls. Who knows what's going on? Okay, I need a perception check from you guys. 1, 2, 3. Okay, yeah, there's looks like there's like claw marks on the ground. There's some sort of...
Xenos.
Xenos, that would be 40K parlance for alien.
Okay, there is, in fact, a Xenos presence here. You guys are getting ready. Around the corner, all of a sudden, you are surprised! You can chant. You can take a check now to avoid that surprise. Ready? One, two, three. Oh, you're awesome. Ready? You guys are in the back. You can see around him. The rest of you aren't going to be able to see. Ready? One, two, three.
100, 100.
Shouldn't there be one more one? Okay, excellent.
And you wonder why the jetpack doesn't work.
We don't know it doesn't work. Okay, so termagants. They're small. They're about this high. Okay.
Thank you.
They skitter around the. They think they're going to surprise you, but you guys are ready. Ready? Uh-oh. One, two, three. Nice. And around him, you go one, two, three.
100, 100.
Nice. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. I like it. Nice. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Okay. Okay. There's a guy dying. There's a carapace is flying everywhere. Okay. There's Ichor, or is it Icker? I don't know. Okay. It's flying all over the place. The walls are pasted with it. There's little pieces of shells. They finally get to you, though. Ready? You guys all together? One, two, three.
Wrong!
We're not guardsmen anymore.
Okay.
That's our chance.
That would be a critical miss on the part of the termagant mob. They pull a Michael, and they trip, and they slide down the hall. Okay. Now, the space wolf around the shoulder pad, giant, enormous Games Workshop shoulder pads of his friend, sees these aliens on the ground like... Ready? One, two, three. Okay. With a pistol. Takes a few more out. Michael's like, what? What's what? Okay, ready? This is your psychic check. One, two, three. Okay, there's something going on up front. There's a bunch of animals, and who knows what's going on. Okay? So now it's the next round of combat. They're stunned because they fell so quickly. So you guys, shooting. 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 And you do have a psychic ability. Smite is not just good for blowing up brains. It also takes out a bunch of guys at once if you want to use it. What the heck? Okay, let's not use the jump pack in the in the hallway, though. Okay, ready? The point man. One, two, three. And then there's the tech marine.
100, 100, 101.
I didn't even say 1, 2, 3, and you guys made it. Okay, space wolf. 1, 2, 3. And Michael. There was a little stutter there.
Oh, no,
okay.
Love for
it. It goes off, it catches a couple guys, but that's okay because these guys are like, these are, and then you just go. All the termagants are wiped out. They're dead. Yay! We've killed them all.
Boo. Okay. Boo.
You are the most pathetic termagant, and then.
Boo.
Yeah, you guys, yeah, of course. That's how my orcs used to shoot, so that's still where I go. Okay? Okay, so you make it all the way down. Now, this is where the astropath is. You guys know that because you're tech marine. You're a tech marine. Okay? But there's a giant wall, a huge door, I mean, sealed. How do we get in?
We
unseal. Grenade. Plug into the... Hack the door?
Blow it up.
Hack into the system, okay? You guys are like, not my area of expertise. Shoot it. Okay, what's the leader have to say? Blow it up. Okay. The tech marine says no. Ready, you guys? One, two, three. One, two, three.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1.
They are good, harsh. They were good.
We all know who the real leader is.
I'm going to give it to Michael. Okay, Michael, you've decided. Get out of the way, tech marine. We're going to blow this up. Okay, you used to be an assault marine, so you specialize in melt-a-bombs. They're about this big, shaped charge. Everybody else is looking at you like, perhaps not the best idea in an enclosed environment, but you will not be gainsaid! You slap that melt-a-bomb on that door. What are you doing?
Backing
away. Hey, backing away.
Oh, no.
And what are you
shooting?
Because you're like, boom, right there. Backing up. Okay, this is everybody trying to back up very, very quickly. Ready? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
1, 2, 3.
Everybody gets around the corner just before, boom, the dwarf comes flying down the hall. Nobody gets hit. We're okay. Peek around the corner. Yeah, okay, look, there it is. Okay, the door has ripped off its hinges. It's no longer secure. There's no way you can get in there now and be safe. But you can get inside. Okay, you get inside, and in this giant throne that has wires attached to it, this is where the astropath would normally sit so that he can project his presence all over the galaxy, is a desiccated husk. Perception check. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1.
They're hardcore, man. 1, 2, 3. Okay, and you guys have bonuses because you're space wolves, so you guys are the ones who notice, wow, there's a bunch of wrappers of food all around the feet. This guy probably closed himself in here at the last minute when the aliens came, and he has since starved to death inside this room. Therefore, that is what happened to the astropath. So you have now made your primary objective. Unfortunately, you cannot safely ensconce your new astropath in this chamber until you fix the door, which we'll do later because, you know... We've got other things to worry about.
If time permits.
Okay, if time permits. There you go. Okay, so now what we have to do is, the next thing is find out what happened on this planet. We've taken care of the governor. We've taken care of what happened to the astropath. Now we need to the train.
Come on, ride the train. Now ride it.
We're going to bomb the train. Wow. We're going to put a thermonuclear device on the train.
My guys are
going to
ride the train, then shoot it.
What's that? That'd be safe. What?
My guys are going to ride it, then shoot it.
Ride it and then shoot it. Shoot the train?
Yes.
Okay, what do you want them to do?
I want to take the train. Yeah, the train
What's
song.
What's the train song? I don't know.
Come on, ride the train. Now ride it.
Okay. And then choo-choo, everybody.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah. Apparently the train is on automatic, so you're going to have to test to jump on it.
And do the Dance Central moves while you
no,
do it.
No, no dancing. Okay, ready? One. Everybody, you know what's going on. Okay, we'll try our best. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Come on, ride the train. Now ride it.
Oh, that was really good.
Okay, there you go. All right. You're good sports. All right. So there's a giant, enormous freight hauler. Sorry, we can't give you dignity. We're all out of dignity.
You're
we used
in the
ours
room.
Up years ago. Okay. So, you finally make it into the depot. You're, let's see, that would be the Devastator. Okay, you guys make a check. 1, 2, 3. And the Space Wolf. 1, 2, 3. Okay, you're both making your perception checks. There's tracks all over the place. They're much heavier and deeper than a Termagant, however. So you're going to try to track it down. The Space Wolf makes it easily. It's this giant warehouse in front of you. It turns into a semi-tractor trailer truck. Okay. Okay, so there's a huge double doors for these massive freight haulers to go in and out of. You know there's something bad in there. What's our plan? What's our heavy bolter guy going to do? The doors are shut.
Ram it with the train.
The train's gone. You're off the train. Nice try, though. Shoot the door.
Into the train.
Blow it up. At least they're not doing what you did.
It's consistent.
Okay, you guys are going to try to open the door if you win, and...
Turn the handle.
Check the door. Ready? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1.
1, 2, 3. Okay, I'm going to give it to you guys. So you're like pushing everybody out of... Whoa, 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 with the bombs, okay? And the tech marine kind of kneels down in front of the door, and then it's like binary. He's like doing a dial-up.
It's a dial-up 1200 baud.
Okay. And the door doesn't do anything.
There's
and
no
then the
broadband
space wolf's
in the future.
Like, and kicks the tech marine out of the way because that's the kind of guy he is, and goes. Okay. Sometimes it's not so high tech. Okay. But now there's a bunch of termagants charging at you. Okay. You got to test so that you're surprised. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Threw them off. 1, 2, 3. Oh, 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1.
Okay, once again, you guys are not surprised. You guys are like, and you guys are like, wait, guys, did you? What's the address? Okay, ready? So you're shooting, I assume, at a giant mob. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0.
Okay, there's a fusillade of fire going out. These guys are like, coming at you, and you're blowing them away.
Ooh, combat
right.
music.
We've got mood music.
Right.
Okay. You wipe them out easily, and then you guys finally get up, and you're like, bub, 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 bub. Yes, gangster. okay? And then make a check. Make it good, okay, for this smite. One, two, three. I give it to you. Okay, your psychic power comes roaring out of your hands and wipes out the rest of them. So the big door is now open. There's a carpet of dead bugs all over the place. Do my part? Oh, Starship, you're dead, that's right. Would you like to know more? Okay, so now it's dark in there. Who knows what's in there? You hear... It's a T-Rex.
It's Russ after he ate the big burger.
Burger.
I got a lot of beef in me.
Burger.
Okay.
I really wish we had some grenades.
We got some grenades. It's okay. Okay, coming out of the shadows is this huge thing. It's about three times the size of you guys, and you are each 8 feet tall. So it's huge. It shoulders its way through. You're going to make a Xenos knowledge check. Ready? One, two, three.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
One, two, three.
One,
two, three.
One, two, three.
One, two, three. Okay, you guys have awesome perception, and you're really smart with Xenos stuff, so you got bonuses, so you both know, oh my god, it's a hive tyrant. These are the leaders of the Tyranid army. They're huge. They're amazingly difficult to kill, and they're extremely deadly in hand-to-hand combat. And it's shouldering its way through the doors. It's almost upon you because you were busy killing all the little things. Okay, so I need to know tactically what each of you is planning on doing.
Shooting
while backing up. Closing the door.
Throwing a grenade in its mouth.
Flank.
What?
Flank.
Flanking. Ooh, I like that. Nice, I like it. Okay, ready? So, one, two, three. As you back up. Okay, you guys. One, two, three. Okay, you got totally closes in its shoulders. Like, and then it slowly pushes it open. And looks at you like, seriously? Okay, one, two, three. Okay, the grenade flies right into its mouth. Okay, you guys. One, two, three. Nice, you're like jumping over all the stuff and you're getting around its flank for the next turn. Okay, now it is the Hive Tyrant's turn. I need something from you guys.
What sound are we making this time?
Give us a one, two, three.
One, two, three.
Snicker, snack, snicker, 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 snack.
Okay, I'll give it to you. Okay, you guys backed up. That was good. You guys were, like, throwing a grenade. That was okay. You guys are flanking. You guys ran forward to shut the door. Okay? You get picked up by the Hive Tyrant and lifted up into the air. I'm going to give you one chance to make your armor save. One, two, three. Okay, you kind of make it, but you feel the just constricting and it's slowly closing its hand, and it gets three attacks, according to Ross. So, ready? Another one. One, two, three.
Snicker snack.
Are you all supposed to be doing it together?
Yes. That's our many hands. We have lots going on here.
I did not pick that.
It's complicated, Craig.
Okay.
It's a thing.
That attack missed, then, if you're all supposed to be doing it in sync. Ready? One, two, three.
Snicker snack.
This is...
We got many limbs here.
I know you have many
limbs.
But, okay, so yeah, you guys don't take any damage. All right, so it's the next turn, however. Ready? You guys are going to... Shoot as you back up. You can't do that. He wants to activate your jump pack remotely. I'll come back to you guys.
Shoot him!
Shoot. Oh, you're in the flank. Very nice. What do you guys want to do? Crack grenade at his knees. You guys are making called shots left and right. I like it. Okay, ready? Backing up and shooting. One, two, three. Okay, you guys are... Oh, you're being held, but you're going to try to force sword to the face. One, two, three. Okay, you guys are going to crack grenade his knee. One, two, three.
One, zero, zero, one.
And you guys are finally shooting with your flanking bonuses. One, two, three. I like it. Okay, so the thing starts to stagger. It's taking some damage. Okay, one, two, three. I like it. Okay, you've got your force sword, and it's like wedged inside its neck, and you're like slowly pushing it down, which is hard because it's like... Okay, crack grenade. This is a called shot. It's difficult. One, two, three.
One, zero, zero, one, zero, zero, one.
Right in there. Boom! Right into the knee. The thing staggers in the other direction. Ready? One, two, three. Okay, with bonuses, it's like getting shot in the head. It's staggering all around. It's making three more attacks on you guys.
Snicker, snack, snicker, snack, snicker, snack. Choppy, 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 lick, lick, lick. And then the tyrant scream.
Okay, I'll give it to him. Okay, that one starts to crush you. You take a lot of damage, okay? It's going right through your armor, because Raef hates power armor.
Okay. That's right.
So you're like starting to feel it. You feel ribs cracking. You feel bones snapping. You feel the toughness of your body is slowly being squeezed. Okay, another attack. One, two, three.
Snicker snack, snicker snack, snicker snack. Chomp, chomp, chomp. Licky, licky, licky. Ah!
Okay. Give you, that last one was pretty harsh. Okay.
It's the hive tyrant scream.
Okay, there's
plus 20.
Blood starting to come out of the seams of your armor as you're like, oh, he got you. One more time. One, two, three.
Snicker snack, snicker snack, snicker snack. Eat a Snickers. Don't eat McDonald's. It's bad
okay,
for
that
you.
One missed.
Even though it's made of soy.
Okay, you're going to need to make a toughness check in order to stay conscious. One, two, three. You do. You're like, oh, I will not fight. I can't sing. Okay, ready? This is going to be a concerted attack by everybody to try to bring this guy down. Ready? On the count of three, everybody is going to do their stuff, and they're not going to stop till I tell you to stop. You see me sweating? It's time for you guys to sweat a little bit. Okay, ready?
Going to hand him out.
Everybody? Brace yourselves. Ready? We want to upset all these anime people in the hallway. What are they doing? They're having a lot of fun in there. Okay. Ready? One, two, three.
Nice.
Okay, it staggers around. It's being hit from all sides. The heavy bolter shells are just ripping huge chunks out of it. The bolters and the crack grenades are just staggering it. Giant gaping holes in its head. Michael is just hacking at that spot on its neck. And the flanking space wall bolt guards just... Bah, 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 bah. Slowly it staggers and falls down. Ready? One last check. One, two, three. Awesome. You do like a somersault as it falls out of its hand. You roll back up. You're like... Pff, and it dies.
Yeah!
The psychic librarian senses all over the planet a shriek as if a million people screamed at once. And then we're like, crap, what do we do now? Okay, their leader is dead. There's nowhere else to go. You guys have successfully, unlike these guys, okay, freed Belial Secundus. Congratulations! Give yourselves a hand! Thank you very, very much.
That was awesome.
You by the way, when we really did that, for those of you who hadn't listened to that part of the podcast, that was my first total party kill ever.
Yes.
As a GM. And I think I've developed a taste for it. So I was kind of hoping that you got... Yeah, you only had one Hive Tyrant. You didn't have Hive Tyrant and guards. And
Journey Warriors.
You didn't have the Lictor. Yeah, but... Yeah. That's true. Yeah, you couldn't make the fatal mistake of separating your party and jumping down through a giant hole. There you go. So there you go.
That was a brilliant.
Yay! Give a hand for Craig.
Thank you very much.
We've got like 10 or 15 minutes left. We thought we'd do Q&A is the last part. If anyone wants to ask any questions, we'll give out the last few of the prizes to any good questions or bad questions. So... Does anyone have a question? Nicole, you want to do the mics for everybody?
Here comes Oprah.
Oh, hey. Hi, how are you guys?
look under your chair.
What are you guys looking forward to for the rest of the con? Like, anything you're really looking forward to doing?
That's a good question.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Okay, next question.
Yes, I'm looking for... I haven't really had a chance to mill around yet. It's been like half milling, half work. So I'm looking forward to chill and see what's out there.
I am looking forward to actually getting to play the X-Wing game instead of just watch Russ play it.
It's cool. I want to try Dust Warfare. No, I just walked over. Just walk over. It's right in their little... I was doing both, actually. I like Focus a lot because it depends on your ship. You can switch it out. I want to try Dust Warfare.
I want to try that.
On my list.
I'll try that.
And
with you.
Looking forward to True Dungeon tomorrow.
Yep.
And we'll see. I haven't checked out a whole vendor hall yet.
Nicole, what are you looking forward to?
I wanted to see the X-Wing game, and I already got to see that.
Okay, well, so there you go. You're good.
That's my thing. I'm good. I can go home now. Yeah.
Yes.
Have you guys got to see any behind-the-scenes stuff with any of your press passes or any of that sort of thing?
No. We haven't really taken advantage of the press pass. Did you see the line to get in when it was press only?
You came in early, didn't you?
I got two things. I got to interview a woman named Shelley. I don't remember her last name, for the Neverwinter campaign. And that was really cool. The iPad pod failed, though, I think. So I have 20 minutes recorded of an interview. It says 20, but it won't play. I'm hoping Russ can fix that somehow.
No.
But I wrote it down in my pad. I know all what's going on. And the other thing I did is I did come in early. We'll get you next. I came in early. I got to talk to Ross Watson and Sam Shepard for the Black Crusade. That was really cool.
Oh, we did actually. Russ and I and Nicole actually had dinner with Ross Watson. So.
We did. We had dinner.
So that, I guess technically that would be.
Oh, yeah. And we got the scoop on Realmworks this morning.
Oh, yeah. We talked to Lone Wolf about their new GMs.
Looks really cool.
Yeah, it looks awesome.
The demo for anyone. So if you go by their booth, they'll show it how it works. Yeah. It's pretty cool.
Yep. Yeah, right there. Nope. You, sir. Yes. Oh, hold on. Let's get you the microphone.
The listeners at home will not be able to hear you without it.
What would you like to see at Gen Con that isn't already here? For example, I would like to see a bigger free play area.
Oh, that's good. That's a good question. I don't have an answer.
I would like to see cheaper decaf diet Coke.
Yes.
Yeah.
$3 seems like a little bit extortionate. And that's coming from a free market guy.
Nothing. I think I'm pretty happy with. I like the milieu of what's out there. I love the vendor part. That's what I love, even against Adepticon. I love the fact that the vendors here are showing off their wares. So I guess more vendors.
Yeah, I think it's pretty well represented. I think there's a good supply of stuff here. I don't know what I'd want to add more of, except maybe just even more smaller companies. My only thing I get nervous about Gen Con is so many of the big companies are taking even more space. I think it's going to get more expensive for the little companies. So I hope Gen Con always is able to accommodate the smaller stuff because it's so fun. Those are some of the best guys to talk to because they're so energized about their games and they have really cool ideas and it's just fun to chat with them. And hopefully I'm looking forward to trying to get with some of them with a recorder this weekend and just get a little montage of maybe 5 or 10 minutes of a few of those folks too for the show because it's fun.
And like most things in life, as a piece of advice, if you look confident that you're supposed to be there, nobody will ask why you're there. So yesterday we used the Dungeons & Dragons room as free gaming space. As long as you look confident like you're supposed to be there, they don't really dare to come over and say, hey, are you guys supposed to be playing Dungeons & Dragons? So that's just. There are tables if you want to kind of just brazen it out. Other questions?
Wow, look at that music.
The fatherland!
I'll go game specific for a second. I had a voice before that. the play by mob. Dystopian Wars came onto the scene and really just exploded in popularity out of nowhere. Do you guys have specific theories as to why that game caught on so quick?
I do. I think it's a huge.
It's the writing.
It's the writing. The writing.
It's the writing.
It's not the writing. Well, it could be.
Since
that would be
2 months
that
ago.
Would be me. I think it fills a niche. I think steampunk is huge. I think all you have to do is walk around the vendor hall to see all the different steampunk costume places that sprang up out of nowhere over the last couple years. And I think it's a decent game engine that is a lot more streamlined than Firestorm Armada. So fans of the company that were like, it's a little too fiddly, except for the fighters, which are fiddly. I think it really fills a niche because of its theme, and I think the mechanics are really much more solid. So anybody who had Spartan Games on their radar, this really fulfills the promise that's been sort of shown over the last several years. And this, I didn't write any of it, so this book has a lot more background. It's really a more fleshed out, fully realized rule book. The models are insane. And I think it's just really intriguing to have a game system that can do in the air, on the sea, and on land all at the same time.
Semperfy. Marines.
Semperfy indeed. And do it well, I think. That was my theory.
I think it's the models.
The models are, you talk to gamers, they don't even know how the rules are. Like, I'm buying that Prussian thing with a deck on top that floats.
Yep.
Spartan's gotten to the point now where the sculpting is probably one of the best in the industry, if it's not the best of the resin. Everything else is awesome, but I think that's the key.
Yeah. The models are unbelievable.
Yeah.
Steve from Iowa. How are you guys?
Hi,
good,
Steve.
How are you?
Yeah,
hi,
good.
Steve.
Just a quick question about miniature gaming. I never have gotten into it before because, number one, I'm not a painter.
Number two, I can't stand sitting playing around with tape measures. Just not my thing.
Okay.
Do you think the two latest movements in like Tannhauser's Pathfinder or Dust Tactics, the center eye, and then actually having some of these games with pre-painted miniatures will grow that? I mean, it almost sounds like a loaded question. Do you think it's growing the business and helping get a lot of people into it that weren't in before? Or is it doing the opposite and losing some of the hardcore, you know, really...
All right, it's funny you mentioned that because I think I've said this to Craig like six times this trip. I said I think the trend
repeats himself a lot.
I think the trend right now is for miniature gaming companies to put out board games with hobby components in them. If you look at like Puppet Wars, and you look at like a lot of stuff Private Press has done. There's other games coming out, Battletech and Leviathans, even the prepaints. There's this desire to bring it together. I think they understand that some people aren't. You know, you like the models, and maybe you want to paint them, or the option of them pre-painted, but not everybody likes there's a lot of extra work. Even if you're a model painter, having a table in your house to play on and all the terrain and all that work to make it look cool is a lot of work, too.
Yeah.
So to have the ability that all comes with everything you need, you know, look at like things like Heroescape and Battleship Galaxies.
Battlelore.
I think that's all sort of trending. There's a trend there. I don't think miniature gaming is going away, but I think there's some hybrid stuff happening.
I don't think it's going to hurt the miniature gaming hobby at all. I think it's, and I don't think it's a gateway game to miniature hobbies. I think it's become its own hobby.
I think companies are recognizing exactly what you're saying, that there are people out there who are intrigued by that, but they don't want to worry about all that fiddly stuff, and they're now filling that niche, I think, more and more every year. Any other questions?
Yeah, sure.
Hey. Well.
So they reported sales figures for last year. The industry across the board seemed to be up, but Hasbro and Mattel seem to be down in terms of sales. Do you think that's because the mainstream is moving towards the hobby side of gaming, or the mainstream is moving away from gaming in general?
Well, that's a new question.
I don't know Hasbro's and Mattel's holdings, but I would suspect it has to do with that they have holdings in there that just aren't doing so good, you know, that aren't necessarily gaming-related even.
Game sales.
Oh, I see. Okay.
If I had to guess, I would think it's the economy. As companies like Hasbro are so massive, and they depend so much on just, you know, big box store sales like Monopoly and Sorry and all those games. So when the economy takes a hit, those companies take a hit. But I think smaller niche markets don't normally feel it quite as much. So I don't know that the smaller hobby industries see it as badly as the bigger. That's my guess. I don't know. No. I'm not an expert.
What Russ said.
Carl from North Dakota.
Hey, Carl.
So,
What town?
Well, now it's Bismarck. It's not Minot anymore.
Oh, it's not Minot?
Yeah, no, it's not Minot.
It never was Minot. Okay, got it.
Anyway, I was wondering, do you find it difficult when you come to Gen Con to balance the D6G aspects of what you do and actually being a gamer and just trying to stay under the radar and go play?
Good question.
They hide it really well by getting these shirts that say the D6G generation in the back.
To be honest, I actually am feeling a bit agoraphobic this year. I think because I didn't come last year and I'm a little overwhelmed. And this year I've been meeting a much greater number of listeners, which is awesome. But at the same time, I'm feeling more pressure like, oh, I've got to go interview people and I'm a little anxious. And so I do, because I kind of want to be like, I just want to go over and look at stuff. And then I'm like, you know, oh, but we got Matt Wilson at such and such a time, and that, which is awesome. But at the same time, I'm like, I kind of want to go under the radar and take my shirt off. This one, not this one. Just this one.
Craig, can I sign your boob?
Yeah, Don't believe me, nobody wants to see that.
I want to sign it.
Signed it.
I'll pay
Nice. Wow.
No. Greg's boob.
Wow.
That's $300.
Okay, moving on.
What do you think, Raef?
I'm going to give you the honest answer. Sometimes I get a little annoyed, like I'm playing a demo and then someone comes up to me, but it's only for like half a microsecond, because then when I turn around, I'm like, hey, man, this guy's cool. He's a gamer just like me, and we just start talking about the game. And so I like it. I think I saw some people back here, like they wanted to take a picture with me. I mean, that's like the coolest thing ever. So it can sometimes get trying, but you guys are so respectful. I mean, it's not like playing and somebody walks up and is like, hey, by the way, blah, 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 blah. I mean, they wait. And I actually feel bad because I turn around. I'm like, oh, my God, were you waiting like that whole 20 minutes? Because I didn't notice, and then I feel like I'm wasting your time. And So that's the honest answer. I overall like it. I think it's cool.
A quick shout out to you guys, because we talk to other podcasters, not John, because his listeners are awesome also. But we listen to, we talk to other podcasters, and like, oh, guys, how do you deal with all the negative emails and the people that come up to you? And
yeah, we don't get them.
Literally, we've had one negative email in the last 3.5 years, and it was not warranted. but no, we I think it has a lot to do with Russ right at the beginning said, let's go no hate, which is good. Whatever else we're doing seems to be working, because the people that listen and the people that come up and you'll see Raef maybe roll his eyes a little bit, but Russ and I are very excited whenever you talk to us. So, you know, if Raef doesn't want to, you know, whatever. But yeah, it's just, we feel so strongly about how just really cool you guys. I mean, you don't see any, I mean, everybody seems to be bathing regularly. There's none of that issue.
We take notes.
There, you know, no hammerheading. I mean, it's just really nice, polite. When we were doing the Lone Wolf demo today, somebody literally stood off to the side where we couldn't even see them for 20 minutes before coming over and wanting to talk to us and shake our hands, because he didn't want to interrupt. And so whenever these other podcasters are like, how do you do it? Like, we don't know what you're talking about. Our people are awesome. So thank you, and thank everybody within the sound of my voice.
That's cool.
Well, I wanted to say one thing so you didn't get the wrong impression, too. Like, please do come up, because I'll see people looking at me sometimes. I don't know if they're just checking out the jersey, and I'll look at them. And so, yeah, come up. Say hi. So don't take what I just said. I don't want to be bothered. No, I'd rather you come up.
He's excited. He just hides it well.
Okay, you guys, you just mentioned the no hate, and
I hate you.
Wow!
I lent you my Sharpie.
He gets a game. I know. For that. Give the man a game. Being insulted by Granger.
I don't really hate you.
Thanks, man.
Just
I love
right
you
now.
Too, man. You mentioned no hate on the show. Do you find that hard? Like a new big game will come out.
No.
You know that maybe isn't that good, and you kind of as a podcast have to not mention it.
Well,
have you met Russ?
No. Well, here's a good example. I played Leviathan yesterday, and I was not blown away by it. Now, I to be fair to the game, it's a demo, and they turn half the rules off. But we don't generally review games we don't like.
Right.
And so, if it's a hot game, we'll mention achievements. We'll be like, yeah, we tried this. It was okay. And if you never hear us mention it again,
right.
That's why, right?
Yeah. You could study it and see, like, we mention it, oh, somebody got this game, and then in the next episode, oh, we're looking forward to playing this game, and then you never hear about it again.
Right.
That probably not a good sign.
But we try not to say, oh, that game sucks. It's just...
That's not in our nature to be like that, to make the show about that.
Right. Except about magic. That's right.
I mean, and that's usually
the
easy...
Magic,
yeah.
And GW for you. No, you were particularly harsh on them.
I do not hate GW. Just...
Yes, you do.
No.
Hey, I had a question for Raef.
Yes.
Any news on the job front?
Oh, my job.
Yes.
Thanks for asking. Yeah, I decided to – I still have a couple tendrils out there for in-house counsel. But what's interesting is developing my own practice again has, like, taken right off. I kind of fought that. But that's for me.
Just answer it.
I bill for that. It's $250 right there. And so my own practice. So I've relaunched my practice up in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. It's exciting. I'm working a virtual office, and yeah, like the phone's ringing off the hook. So that's a good sign. And I'm enjoying it. I'm not burnt out. So I think my year at the state helped me somehow. Probably because I ate donuts and stood by water coolers and stuff.
One more question over here. We got time for probably two or three more
questions. Thank you. Thanks for asking.
Yep.
I've got a two-part question.
Uh-oh.
Sure. First is, as parents, what do you guys think about bringing your kids to Gen Con? What would be a good age to do that?
And 13.
The second question is, have you seen any good kid games while you're here?
Well, Nicole
Shooting
talking,
bears.
Nicole and I were just talking about the kid thing. What were we talking about today about that?
Well, we brought the kids to PAX East, but we were there the whole time, and it's like a driving distance, so we can go down for 3 hours, and if the kids are toast, we can leave. For this, the thing is, you can't... Like, if you get here at 10 o'clock and you leave at 2 a.m., you're going to have a child you're just dragging along behind you. So they really have to be old enough to be on their own, which to put two kids out on their own in a convention this size in a big city, I think I personally, to just take them all the way from New Hampshire to here, I'd want them to be, like, almost in high school, like a 14-year-old kid that I knew could make a reasonable decision about what they were doing, because you can't, there's too much to do with little kids here. There's just too much. There's this much teeny little space of little kid attentions type stuff, and then everything for the grown-ups, so that you'd have to drag them to all your boring grown-up stuff.
This is the longest I've ever been away from my son since he was born last year, right about this time. And you all know that there are babies that come to Gen Con and you see them at like 2 or 3 in the morning and they're all just like zonked out in their little chairs. And in my head, I was like, oh, I know that's going to kill me. I'm going to be all judgmental. But I miss my son so much that I see them and I'm like, oh.
Right. It's a dad now.
And it's like, it really caught me out of left field because I thought I'd be like, oh, how dare you? And instead I'm like, oh.
Right.
My son's asleep right now, too. Of course, he's in his crib. No.
I think it would totally change your Gen Con experience, right, as a parent, right, to bring your child here. So you'd have to be prepared to, like, for us, it's really tough because we try to do so much, kind of back to an earlier question, with the show at the same time. Like, I'll try to schedule, like, today is mostly show stuff, so tomorrow can be mostly fun stuff for us.
But the show's not fun.
Not right. But if we had my girls with me, I see things I'm like, oh, that would be great for them, and that would be great for them. But then I would have to be with them the whole time. So that would be a whole totally different experience. So it's something I'd like to do, but not at a con where I feel Gen Con is sort of part podcast. You know, we're thinking of going to Carnage up in Vermont, and that's totally more of a family thing, not related to anything podcast, and just having bringing the girls up to that, so that kind of thing. So,
for me, I like to get away from my kids for a while because they drive me nuts, and I like to get away from my wife too because she drives me nuts.
This is my
guy weekend. This is when I get to stay up late and stay till 3:30 in the morning. But Lou is starting to get an interest, and I'm starting to get excited to take him because he's getting a real interest in gaming. Like right now, he's playing Magic: The Gathering. So it's what Nicole said. I'm waiting till he's old enough where I could be here and he could maybe be in the magic room and I'm like, okay, you can't leave here till I come back and get you. And so I've decided on 13 unless he's not mature enough to be down the hall. So
okay.
And then I'm looking forward to taking him.
One more. Anybody?
Is that it?
No, that works good.
Great. Well, good timing.
There you go. Okay. Yay. So thank you all
for coming. Really appreciate
thank you.
Spending the afternoon with us.
Thanks. That was awesome. Thank you, everybody.
There you go.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. Born to game.
The War Store, bringing the war to your door for a decade more. War Store features the best prices on the net.
Where'd
great
you get
service.
That
was a pretty good noise there, Raef. Craig, who did that?
Awesome.
It's a Vuvuzilla.
What do you mean?
That's awesome. So, you know, we are big fans of the War Store.
Yes, we are huge fans.
You know, you always got to support your local gaming store, but the War Store carries just so much great stuff at great prices and fantastic service.
Yep.
Like, we were down at Gen Con, right? And now, Gen Con's massive, right? There's lots of places you can buy stuff, lots of places. But you go to the War Store, and it's like they've got this little roped-off area, and it's like all of a sudden you've walked into your own little private gaming store mecca.
Yep.
And you know, there's lots of board games out there, and some people have some miniatures, but the War Store has a wide variety of miniatures, and they had it set up this year. It was like there was this own little, I was calling it the Spartan Games experience.
It was a huge wall.
Because you'd go over there, it was a wall, they had glass cases, like you might find at like a Games Workshop store, just showing off all the wonderful new Spartan releases coming out.
All that new stuff, yeah.
That aren't even out yet. Great displays of all the stuff. There were people just milling about, snapping up whatever they could. It was a really great experience. They're all even though it was mob, they're all friendly and saying hi to everyone. And it was just really, really great. One of the things I love about the War Store is they take the time to come to these cons and give you that feeling of like, wow, everything I ever think about ordering online is all here at my fingertips.
That's what I like about the War Store is they're the greatest generalist out there. You know, when you're
really
at Gen Con, everybody's specializing in what they do, whether it be minis or Fantasy Flight and their own board games, but you go to the War Store and that's where you can get your generalist stuff,
right.
You know?
Especially,
and I guess they were the exclusive distributor of Spartan Games, not just Dystopian Wars, right?
Well, all the newest stuff. Yeah, another great thing about the War Store at Gen Con in particular is they don't compete with all of the manufacturers who go to Gen Con. They only bring stuff that doesn't really have a Gen Con presence. So, like, for instance, the Weird Miniature booth is right next door to the War Store booth. Well, there's no Weird Miniatures in the War Store for the weekend. They're supporting everybody. I mean, they're just great guys. They're always pleasant, no matter how rushed and hectic it is.
Right.
And they got some awesome $2 bins, by the way. You could get an entire army of War Master stuff probably for about $20.
And we have a little, unfortunately, a little sad news.
Yes, indeed.
It turns out that the War Store Weekend, which you've been talking about for a while and we're very excited about, had to be delayed this year, actually canceled for 2011, and we're back in 2012. Well, it turns out that Neil, the owner of his War Store, and his wife, their parents have been having some health problems for a while now, and it's just been getting a little rough. They put up a nice post explaining the whole thing on the War Store website. So if you want to know more about that, you can go there. You can post a reply and let Neil and everyone there know that how you feel about them and want to support them and everything. And so they're very sorry, and we're sorry to hear that, and we hope everything works out for them. Mm-hmm. So, but if you want to support Neil and you've been a fan of his in the past, just head over to the War Store, make a little purchase, and send a little money his way, helps him get through that hard time, and helps him get all that stuff done too. So it's a nice way to let them know you're thinking of them and drop them a note too. I'm sure it'll make them feel better about that. Yeah. So,
and I'm sure they'll come back stronger than ever in October of 2012.
They were, and you know, that's the thing I'm professional about Neil. You know, this has all been going on for a couple of years. He's at Gen Con laughing it up, working really hard, putting on a good face, making sure he's having a good time. And you know, in the back of his mind, he's worried about all that stuff. So that just shows you how professional he is and how much he cares about his company, about his customers.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
And if you want to make sure you know what the latest going on in gaming releases, make sure you follow Vic the Viking from the War Store on Twitter at the War Store.
Twitter.
Twitter.
Do the Twitter.
I'm Raef, Hollywood Granger, and this is the Hollywood Minute. All right, well, here we go. This is part two of Ian and Rafe's comic primer. But first, I've got to say, from a guy who stepped up to the plate after a pretty hard ribbing I gave him on the air, Ranger Dave. I love you, Ranger Dave. And this is what he says here on the front of the Hollywood Minute. To all the folks I hung out with at Gen Con, I won every game I played, even those so-called cooperative games. Sorry to have crushed you so badly. See you in 365. Wait, that's not true. But hopefully I met Hollywood and thanked him for his great part in a great podcast. Thanks, Ranger Dave.
I was going to get into some don'ts. Don't collect a comic just because it's a number one. Now, I know we just talked about after Flashpoint there's going to be DC number one. And it is, they are trying to get a number one, but they're also trying to clean up their story arcs. But a lot of times, you know, you'll walk in, and this is where the comics store owner, depending on where you go, is like, you know, just to let you know, Amazing Daredevil, I'm making that title up, you know, it's a little side Daredevil, they're renumbering it to number one, don't get suckered into that. Hey, if you love Daredevil and you want to own everything Daredevil, go for it. But don't just get sucked into it, because when you're new, you might be buying a number one of a one out of three story arc, you know? So try to avoid that. Don't collect a comic just because everyone else does. There's some comics that people love that I hate. I just don't enjoy them. Another don't is don't buy a comic as an investment. That could be, and Ian's nodding his head up and down, that can be the biggest one. Sure, are there some comics that are worth a lot of money? Yep. Are there some comics that me and Ian own that are worth a lot of money? Yep. Did we collect them because they were investments? No. Well, in my case, okay, Ian's shaking his head no because it sounds like he sells them off. But yeah, I've got some Spider-Mans that go back because I've got Todd McFarlane. I've got the issues of Todd McFarlane. I've got a couple that on paper are worth $50 to $70 a pop. And that's just because I liked them and I collected them, so I had them since the 80s. Did I buy three of them so I could sell one of them off? No. So there's my investment. What am I going to do if I sell it for $50? Well, now I don't own it anymore. You know what I mean?
Right, right. And that was actually in the mid-90s, there was really that whole investor mentality really brought comics down to a pretty low point because there were so many different, like a number one would come out and they'd print, some printed as many as like 8 or 9 different covers to try and get people to buy each and every one of them. And they had chrome covers and foil covers and, you know, prismatic covers and anything you can think of, you know, solid gold plated covers.
Yep,
and
yep.
It was just ridiculous stuff. And what happened was the investors found out that these weren't worth anything because they're printing so many, and the real comic fans knew to stay away from them. So it ended up nearly destroying the whole comic book market because so you had this big boom and then a big crash. So
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And you're going to see that now. You're going to see variant covers, and you're going to see different artists on those covers, and you're going to see the comic stores pricing them differently too. You're going to have your regular pricing of $3.99, and then there's going to be one they're selling for $10 right there. And we'll talk about how to go ahead and collect the variant if you want. And then going back to pulls, don't buy a comic because it's in your pull. A lot of things that, well, I mean, buy it if it's the one you ordered, but a lot of times the comic store owner is putting in, say, hey, just to let you know, Raef, I know you like Amazing Spider-Man. They are doing a little shoot-off here, 1-6 issues of Amazing Spider-Man. I put that in there because I figured you'd like it. Are they trying to sell you more comics? Of course. Are they doing it because they think they're doing you a favor? Of course. Do you have to buy it? No. I don't think you have to buy it. Do you think, Ian?
No, if it's something, and even stuff that you order, unless you've ordered something really exclusive and expensive and rare that they're not going to be able to sell to anybody else, 9 times out of 10 your comic shop is going to, if you say, hey, you know what, I'm sorry I didn't tell you guys to take this off my pull list, I'm really not enjoying this book, can I put this back on the shelf? 9 times out of 10 they're going to say, yep, you know what, no problem. It goes right back on the shelf with another bunch of copies, they'll sell it, not a big deal.
Exactly. Something I do to manage my comic pull is if I've ordered it, I pay for it. Unless what Ian just said, I'm just not enjoying Daredevil anymore, guys. Here you go. Here's the 2 back. Yeah, they don't care about that. But that way, because sometimes a comic store will run out. So I take care and attention of what I've got in my pull, and I maintain it very closely so that they're not filling it through stuff that I already don't think I'm going to buy. And the reason why I do that is I want them to know, hey, when Raef comes in, he buys his folder. And the reason why I do that is if they run out of the new Batman Flashpoint, they're going to put the number one in mine, and maybe when they run out, they might not put it in Ian, not to screw Ian, I shouldn't say Ian because he buys his pull, but Joe Bunda, because, you know, they're going to be like, well, he might put it back, so...
Yeah, that guy's always putting them back.
What's that?
Yeah, that guy's always putting
them back. Yeah, that guy, that Joe Bunda guy. All right, so what are some do's about collecting? Why don't you go first, Ian? What are some do's about collecting?
For me, it's and it goes back to the entertainment value I was talking about. If you are enjoying, you know, the run, and you figure out that, hey, this is an artist or this is a writer that I like, go ahead and seek out something else that this person is working on, even if it's not maybe something that you were necessarily interested in. Go ahead and explore new things. If you find an artist that you think, oh, this art is great, or a writer that you think, boy, this guy really, their dialogue is awesome, and So definitely that's a big one for me is feel free to branch out if you find someone or something that you like that you think, you know, there might be more out there like it.
Well, some do's that I think you should do when you're collecting comics is pretty simple. If you like the art, collect it. Go in, look at the cover. Oh, that's a good point, actually. The cover artist may be different than the interior artist, so don't just look at the cover. Look at the cover, then flip through the inside. If you like what you see visually, I say buy it. As far as variants go, if you like the variant cover art that much more and you want to pay more money for it, well, go ahead and buy it. That's the whole fun of this, is to buy what you like. If you like what's in your comic pull that you didn't order, buy that. If you read an article on the comic in the trade magazines, which I guess now there's only one, you should buy that. Listen to your comic store owner. They're going to get to know you after a little while. They're going to get to know what you like by the type of comics that you collect, and there may be a new writer or a new run starting, and they'll suggest something for you, and I think you should do that. Another thing you should do is your friends know you, so they're going to recommend, you know, Ian knew that I liked Ultimate Spider-Man. Excuse me, he knew I liked Spider-Man, and he says, hey, Raef, have you been paying attention to what's going on in Ultimate Spider-Man? And I said, no, I had no idea. I started reading it, and he's right. I really like it. Plus, it's being written by one of the big heavy hitters in the comic industry. Let's talk about Ultimate Spider-Man, not the comic itself, but we haven't talked about alternate universes. We talked about it in the vein of DC having so many different storylines going on, but they're not doing an alternate universe like Ultimate, the Ultimate line in Marvelous. So let's explain to people what that is, since this is a primer.
Yeah, what happened, it's been a while now, probably at least 10 years
now. That's
what I'm
thinking too, yeah.
Yeah, Marvel launched their Ultimate line, and what they wanted to do was to take their core characters, Spider-Man, the X-Men, the Avengers, who are called the Ultimates in that world, and update them, make them more modern, while still staying to the core values of what have made those books so popular for so long. For example, updates in Ultimate Spider-Man would be, instead of Peter Parker being a teenage photographer at the Daily Bugle, he works on their website at the Daily Bugle. stuff like that. And the other thing it did was allow a character like Spider-Man, who's had so much history now in the regular Marvel universe, he's been married and all that type of stuff, take him back to his roots when he was a teenager, when he had all these problems he was facing. So it was a chance for them to do some different things while still keeping the character true to what made him so popular to begin with. And they were able to do that with Spider-Man, X-Men, and the Ultimates, like I said. And it also allowed them to do things like making the like the Ultimates version of the Avengers is a little more hardcore, and like especially the Captain America is more of a soldier using guns and killing and things like that, and is actually probably more toward what we see in the new comic book, in the new Cap movies. So
yeah,
it was a great way for them, and there was a lot of doubt when it happened about whether or not this was going to work, but it's actually produced some of Marvel's best books over the last decade.
Right, so that's a great example of Spider-Man. You mean, again, you hear me talking about it, you know, Amazing Spider-Man is meh. And Ultimate Spider-Man's been pretty good. And I'm behind on that. I started collecting, you know, issue 150, and I think they're up to 160 now. And it ends with the, quote, death of Spider-Man. And so that's a great place for me. I can jump in. Matter of fact, Ian, do you still have all the Ultimate trade paperbacks, or was that one of your eBay?
It was one of my eBays because you didn't get back to me.
I didn't want to buy them.
So I'm like, I'm just going to put them on eBay.
Yeah, you should. You should have sold them because I didn't want to buy them anyway. I didn't want to own them. I just want to read them. So that's a good example of, yeah, where the alternate universe kind of continues. And again, how it can confuse the heck out of you because, you know, like, there's another Spider-Man thing. So I think that those are some of the do's about collecting. Are there any you think I left off before we go to ending tips and then our picks?
No, I think you hit the high points. I mean, it's a hobby. It's supposed to be fun, just like gaming. We enjoy our gaming hobby, and there are games that we like, and
yep.
And there are, you know, systems or game designers that we like, and we follow their stuff. So, when you find an artist or a writer that you like, or a character or whatever, feel free to branch out and try it, because you never know. There could be some hidden gems, and you make a good point about networking too. There's tons of places and people that'll say, hey, if you like this, check this out. I think there's a lot to offer in the hobby, and definitely a lot of there's not a whole lot of wrong ways to go about being a comic book collector.
Yeah. All right, so these are my ending tips. I kind of covered them all throughout, so let me just hit the highlights. Ending tip is utilize your comic pull. Ending tip to begin is decide what you like. What are you collecting for? Is it nostalgia? Is it to remember back in the day? Then go ahead and collect Amazing Spider-Man or Batman or Wonder Woman or whatever it was that you kind of fondly remember. If you want to jump in, whatever, what's new and what hot, you just, you know, hey, Captain America's new and hot, jump in right there. Walking Dead's new and hot. You've seen, you know, if you've seen it on AMC, like, I want to know what this comic's all about. Yep, start there. That's no problem. So utilize your comic pull. Don't be afraid to jump in, and, you know, you don't have to collect 100, just collect a couple to start. Ian, what are your tips for the beginner before we do our picks?
I think something I touched on that is important to remember is that really, like I said, if you don't like superheroes, go find something else. There are tons of other great books out there in the other genres. There's going to be something that you like out there. You know, even specific to games, a lot of times Dungeons & Dragons has several comics out right now.
World of Warcraft has a comic?
Yeah, World of Warcraft, there's tons of them that have comics that are something that you're probably already interested in anyway that you can check out. So definitely don't be afraid to look around and find things that fit your particular interests.
Oh, and don't be afraid if it's not DC and not Marvel. That doesn't mean it's not good. There's a lot of alternative publishers. So if when you were a kid, it was pretty much only DC and Marvel, and everything else might have been, you know, a Warner Brothers knockoff of Star Wars or something. But nowadays, you know, Dark Horse, which produces a bunch of the Star Wars comics, IDW, Dynamite Comics, Image, they're almost mainline now, but Image. So don't be afraid of the publisher. There's a lot of great little publishers out there. I think Atomic 5 is who publishes Atomic Robo. So, don't be afraid of the publishers. All right, so I was thinking about doing some of our picks, and Ian, you've got a good list here. So here's some, again, if you just want to, you know, hear what we like, this is what we recommend.
Yeah, we've obviously talked a lot about Walking Dead, and there's plenty of buzz about that. So if you like horror, you like zombies, that's a great one. You mentioned Lock and Key, another great one. It's written by Joe Hill. I don't know if a lot of people know, but Joe Hill is Stephen King's son. I've read the first two of his novels, and he's a great writer. Lock and Key is great. Ultimate Spidey.
Dead, because I actually don't think of Walking. It's such a good comic. I want to take some time about it. Okay. It's such. I don't think of Walking Dead as a horror comic. I think of it as an apocalypse comic of what we would do in an apocalypse, and it just uses zombies as its vehicles. Because I'm not a horror comic fan, and I love Walking Dead.
Yep, no, I think you make a great point. It's also one of the strong points of The Walking Dead is the characterization and how much you care about the characters, and that they happen to be in a zombie apocalypse setting is almost secondary in a lot of ways in Walking Dead because it's so character-driven.
Yes. And Lock and Key I wouldn't exactly think of as horror. I mean, that's the category it would go in. But
yeah, supernatural.
Lock and Key is almost first of all, it's set in New England, and it's mysterious. It's mysterious slash spooky, yeah. Go ahead. What else do you recommend?
I like if you like the female heroes. There's a great book in the DC universe called Birds of Prey, and it's got. I don't know what'll be happening with the new issues number one, but it's got Oracle and the Black Canary and the Huntress and some really strong of the female characters in the DC universe written by a woman, Gail Simone. So her voice in that is very strong. It's a very good book. I'm loving the new Moon Knight, which is a character I know a lot of people may not know about, but Brian Michael Bendis, who does Ultimate Spider-Man. Is and some other really good books is writing the new Moon Knight. It's only on issue 3, so it's real easy to go back and pick that up. Moon Knight is a character that's had problems with split personalities, and Bendis is really taking this in great directions right now. So for current stuff that's out right now, that would be what's on my pull list.
Ooh, I'm going to pull that one then. I do like Bendis. I had no interest in Moon Knight at all until you just described it.
Yeah, it's very good so far. Like I said, only on issue 3, easy to pick those first ones up.
Okay. What else you recommend?
That's it for new stuff. I love a lot of old stuff. I mentioned going to the cheapo bins at comic shows, and that's one of my favorite things to do. And there's some great books that you can find super cheap. If you say, hey, I can't get to a convention, eBay, get these real, real cheap. I've been rereading a great one from the 80s that probably a lot of people have never heard of, but it's called Strike Force Morituri. And it was done by Marvel in the 80s. It takes place outside of the Marvel continuity, so you're not going to see Spider-Man or anybody like that. But it's an alien invasion one where this alien race called the Horde come to take over Earth and exploit our resources and enslave us. And this doctor finds this process that can give people superpowers, essentially. It enhances something innately within them. Only certain people can do it. All the powers are different. The catch is that it limits their lifespan to a year or less.
Wow.
So these people have powers, but because of that, throughout the course, and it only ran 31, 32 issues, so it's real easy to pick up, main characters from the beginning are going to die off and do so throughout and in violent ways because of the way this process works. And it's a pretty hardcore book. The aliens are really, really nasty. They do a thing called the high dive where they will take captured humans up above the Earth's atmosphere, throw them out of the airlock, and it's like a meteor storm of literally people's bodies burning up on reentry.
Holy cow!
And it's like a mental warfare thing. It's a tremendous book, and I know a lot of people haven't heard of it, but you can probably pick up the whole run on eBay for less than $20.
Holy cow! So that's pretty rare for Marvel to do something that hardcore.
Yeah, it was written by a guy who I don't even know if he's done anything else, but his name's Peter B. Gillis. But the artwork was done by Brent Anderson, who does one of my favorite books, which is called Astro City.
Okay.
And that's another one I highly recommend. That one comes out still sporadically, but you can go pick up the trades of that. And I would recommend among more than others, higher than others, is one called Confession. And you don't have to know anything about Astro City. There's even stuff peppered in there that he hasn't even gotten to, that the writer Kurt Busiek hasn't even gotten to yet. You won't be lost. Pick up the one called Confession. I can't recommend it highly enough. It's a great, great book.
Cool.
So there's lots of other older stuff that's out there that you can pick up that's cheap and that you'll really like. And that's one of the great things about eBay and about those conventions with the dollar and under bins.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think my picks are the same. So if you're brand new and you want to just follow, you know, kind of Ian's picks, Rafe's picks, Lock and Key. We talked about that. Walking Dead, I would start there. I would start in on the new DC, you know, if you like Spider-Man, Batman, The Flash, any of those. I would start in on the number ones there. I'm trying to think of what else that really... Oh, I like Chew. I like the comic called Chew. That's up to issue, I think, 15 by now. The new Max Punisher, I really like the new line of the Max Punisher. He's up to issue 15, so not too hard to jump. But again, you can jump in anywhere there. I think those are my handful of picks. Oh, I like picks. I like anything The Dark Knight Returns. Any of the Batman Dark Knight Returns, I'll pick up, no matter who's writing it. Yeah, so those are my picks.
Yeah, I think it's also important to know that, you know, there are great older stories and that take place outside of continuity. You mentioned the alternate universes, and there are some cool ones from other. Star Wars has a cool one called Infinities, where they take each of the movies and split off one thing differently. Like, for example, in A New Hope, Luke does not destroy the Death Star.
Huh.
And, Alderaan is destroyed. Yavin 4 is destroyed where the base is, and it branches off and goes in a different direction. There's a great Superman one called Red Sun, where Superman's rocket that brings him to Earth, it's like delayed for like something like 8 hours, and instead he lands in Russia and is raised as a like a communist war machine. There's a great one called Gotham by Gaslight, which is a like an 1800s Batman tracking Jack the Ripper. There's tons of really cool things that are in outside of regular continuity that are great one-shot stories that you can pick up with characters that you know, but told a little bit differently. So there's a lot of great stuff out there.
Now, when you say one-shot, is it literally in one comic, or it might be there's six comics or you know, a set of, all in a trade?
Yeah, both. Most of them are a few issues each. But yeah, all available in a trade for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, all the ones I mentioned.
I Gotham by Gaslight. That one skipped me. I'll have to check that one out.
Yeah.
There's a current one like that I've really liked called The Return of Bruce Wayne. He gets thrown back in time. I don't know. I just liked it.
Yep. That was when he was gone, and that was when Dick Grayson became Batman for
a while. Oh, okay. So I didn't know that part of it.
Yep.
All right. Well, I can't think of anything else to say in our comic primer. Hopefully we didn't overload you with too much information, but, you know, the type of thing I think towards the end there, you just, you know, scroll back and pick some of our picks or go back and collect that comic you've always wanted to collect in a long time. Ian, do you want to give out your email address if people should have any questions?
Yeah, absolutely.
Or do you want them to email me and I can forward it to you?
Nope, I don't mind at all. And I know that, you know, people listening aren't just going to be people trying to get into comics. I know there's going to be people that are already hardcore comic fans, maybe even more so than us, and they might want to send suggestions to us too, and I welcome that. But yeah, you can email me at imclark@comcast.net. I'd like to hear, you know, if the listeners pick stuff up and like it or don't like it and want to shoot me an email, I'd love to hear from them.
Yeah, and CC me on that email or email me the same way and CC Ian. All right, guys. Well, that's a little bit of a bonus extended Hollywood Minute, probably broken up in two parts. We'll see how Russ is feeling on that. And other than that, I'll see you in two.
Well, let's say that you're in the mood to kick back and read a little bit more about historical miniature gaming. Well, then the magazine for you is War Games, Soldiers, and Strategy Magazine, historical wargaming at its best. And I have to say that I agree. I love flipping through there and especially looking at some stuff other than Flames of War. They have some, you know, they cover the main big ones of historical wargaming, De Bellis Antiquitatis.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of Flames of War is in there as well. Warhammer Ancient Battles and General D Brigade.
Those are just
a system of
a
rules.
Couple examples. It's not a specific magazine just to that.
Yeah, right.
No. Nope. But those are some of the highlights of the main miniature rule sets that they do. And absolutely. I really like it. If you guys looked at it recently, they've got a whole kind of new color spread. I mean, I wasn't a subscriber back in the day, but they've got a new format to the mag. It looks really nice.
It does look I love the way that it all ties together. Again, like I normally say, the theme, all kinds of things like that. I think it's a fantastic miniature gaming magazine specifically geared towards you historical buffs.
Exactly.
It's cool for me to just look at the pictures too.
I think it's awesome. Well, you're not a historical gamer, because the painting and the way they do the photography in there is just fantastic. It really helps me out, because I don't really know all the historical gaming terms. You know, I know Flames of War. That's about it as far as it goes in terms of acronyms. They usually define all the acronyms for you. They kind of walk you through it in case you're not familiar with all that stuff. It's just a great read. If you're a miniature wargame, you can certainly appreciate all the stuff going on in there and even learn about a few things you may not have known about historical gaming.
Yep. Yeah, it broadens your horizons.
Exactly.
And they offer two subscriptions. You get a hard copy subscription.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's not that newspaper print stuff. It's real quality. It looks like a real magazine.
Oh, yeah,
quote.
Sure.
It is a real magazine.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's got
not a...
What's that?
PDF. It's not an illusion of a real magazine. It is
no,
a real
but some,
magazine.
But sometimes the, you know, the historical wargamers will know in the historical market it could come just in courier font, you know, on a piece of paper.
It's very
right.
true.
It's not one of those. Or you can get a digital subscription, which is pretty handy. And D6G listeners get 5% off any combination of web orders. Check them out at www.wssmagazine.com.
Enter D6G for the savings.
This is Total Fangirl. Regular Jane most days, Total Fangirl when the moment strikes. Han shot first. Starbucks is a guy. And Lestat, now there's a vampire. Hey everybody, this is Nicole, your Total Fangirl. You can find me on Twitter at Nicole Wakeland and check out my blog, TotalFangirl.com. This week's shout-out is from Dan Paddock. Attention all War Machine players in South Central PA and Northern Maryland. Comic Store West in York, PA will be holding a War Machine Wrath release event on August 20th from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. This will be a casual play event. Show up when you can and leave when you want. Faction coins will be awarded to players who perform the most glorious deeds for their faction. Details at comicstorewest.com or privateerpressforums.com. Well, I have just come back from Gen Con, which I know the guys will be talking about in this podcast, and I wanted to talk about it a little bit, too, from my point of view. I had been to San Diego a few weeks back, although it was gigantic and impressive and huge, and Dwarfs Comic-Con. I mean, Dwarfs Gen Con. It was fun, but I was really looking forward to Gen Con, and I wasn't disappointed. This was a fantastic year. The attendance numbers are out, and attendance was up. So it was the biggest Gen Con that they have had. And it was in the convention center as it has been newly revamped. So it was kind of cool because all the regulars that knew where everything was were just didn't know where it was anymore. So they could point and say, well, it used to be there, but now I don't know. So it was kind of fun. Everybody was on a level playing field as far as which direction they were heading. It was really nice. I think they did a great job of how they laid it out this year. It never felt as crowded as it used to feel, even though technically it was bigger. It's a fantastic space, and once again, the city of Indianapolis embraced all the gamers and changed their menus and changed the names of their beers and did all sorts of cool stuff to make all the gamers feel at home, running silly movies in the movie theater. I think Conan the Barbarian was playing all hours of the night in the movie theater right in town. And one of the things that I wanted to talk about is something that probably not everybody saw, but there was a place where you could take cards, like magic cards, and you could build whatever monstrosity you wanted. Somebody actually built a Big Ben with a working clock face. There was also a dragon that people bought. And in the end, you throw coins to destroy this whole thing, and all the coins go to a charity. In this case, it was helping a local Indianapolis children's charity. And I've always seen them building it, but I've never seen the demise. One day it's there and it's growing and they're having to move the stanchions out further and further to accommodate all the people that are building these structures. And the next day it's just a big empty space of carpet. This year I happened to walk by just as they were about to destroy the entire thing. And this had gotten huge. Like I said, it starts off sort of in a cordoned off area in the hall and kind of in a corner. And as people start adding to it, they keep moving it further and further out. And impressive structures. Someone had even made an arch out of cards. They used cardboard to prop it up to build it, and then they pulled the cardboard away, and there was an arch from one part of the floor to the next part, and it was probably about like 4 feet tall. It was pretty impressive, since all I can do are make two cards lean against each other, and that's about it. But I didn't know before is if you're walking by as it all happens, they auction off the first coin toss. The person who gets to throw the first coin at all these magnificent structures and send them, hopefully, crashing to the ground in the name of charity. Well, as I walked up and saw all these people and thought, I'm going to stand and watch this. I've never seen it. They're talking about how they auction it off and how they've had in past years, how much money they've made. And they say, you know, we want to try and beat our number from last year. If you have a couple hundred dollars in your pocket and you're trying to do this, and the guy next to you has $300 in your pocket, his pocket, once you know he's hit more money than what you can possibly spend, hand him your money anyway. Because now he can bid up to $500. You were ready to give that money to the charity. You still want to give it to the charity. Give it to him so that number gets higher and higher. Well, everyone's pulling money out of their pocket, and I was sort of towards the front of all of these people, and the crowd had grown from when I first just happened by and decided to stand there on one side of the display. I turned around and looked, and it went all the way back. It was almost blocking the aisleway, so security was getting all antsy. People were standing on the stairwell so that they could look down and see what was happening. But in the front of the line, the amazing thing was, as I'm standing there, people are shoving $20 bills
and $5 bills and $10 bills over my shoulder to hand to the guys that are actually running the event. And that's what's happening all around here. People are literally just handing money forward, and being so far in the front, I'm seeing all of this money coming forward from gamers who've presumably saved a few pennies to make their way to Indianapolis, and they're ready to just push it forward, not so much for that first toss of the coin anymore, but just for the kicks of making that number high, helping somebody out in a positive way. And they were donating money. There were $50 bills that came forward in that random crowd of people that they just handed the person in front of them and said, pass it on forward. Tons of money. Then somebody who was on the phone with the guy from the charity said, if the people in that crowd can manage to come up with $1,000, I'll match it with another $1,000. If you could have seen all these gamers rummaging in their pockets, in their purses, in their backpacks, and everything else they had, their bags of holding, to come up with cash to donate to this charity, it would have made you cry. I could not believe this. In the end, they got over $1,000. The first person threw their coin and missed, no less. And then after that, everybody else takes their handfuls of coins, and you throw it out into it, and you watch the cards come tumbling down. And it's amazing. I took pictures, just click, 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 and you can see as everything just collapses. And it was sort of a fun event. But the thing that struck me about it was these were a bunch of gamers who just said, okay, I'm going to take the coins I have and I'm going to throw them out there for kicks, and it's going to help a charity. I'm going to dig $5 out of my pocket. I'm going to dig $10 out of my pocket, or even I'm going to dig $1 or a couple of quarters. And they all got together and did something really positive. So this is kind of a pat on the back to all of you. Gamers get a bad rap a lot of times for being sort of the socially anxiety type guys and for being sort of recluses and all the things that you say about geeks. People sort of say it tenfold about gamers. But standing in the lobby in Indianapolis, watching everybody just passing forward money to help a charity and to have some fun, and seeing over $1,000 raised in just a few minutes was pretty impressive. So yeah, for that reason alone, I think Gen Con Indy is going to have to take the cake as my favorite convention of the year.
Hey!
Yes?
What are those things you're playing with?
These are my standard approved wargaming miniatures.
Oh, give me a break. You got a blaster who came to the extreme with the power of Wargamma.
Let's try that again. Wargamma makes resin cast models. We do it all. Miniatures, terrain, figure accessories, and even custom bases. Everything is made with attention to detail, unique design, and maximum versatility. I'm James Hakola, creator of the Wargamma line. My aim is to bring a new and creative look to your miniature battles. Our prices are extremely competitive, and we ship worldwide. You'll find us at wargamma.com. That's
WARGAMMA.com.
Thanks for listening, and good luck on the battlefield.
Imagine being a hero. Imagine fighting the bad guys, saving the world, all that good stuff. Now imagine fighting an enemy you can't see or touch. Extra life. Play games. Heal kids.
You know, we love to talk about our friends at Myriad Games, but...
Myriad Games! So many games, so little time.
Indeed, but Myriad Games is a proud partner with Game Salute.
Game Salute! So many things to salute, so little time.
Right, well, Game Salute's a fantastic site that covers all kinds of gaming coverage. In fact, if you want to know what happened at Gen Con, there are few places you could go with better coverage than Game Salute.
It is the clearinghouse of gaming industry information.
They were literally live blogging from the con. Dan was out there doing mad interviews with just about anybody who would stand still, basically. It was a the other thing that happened this week, kind of a big announcement from the folks at Game Salute, they launched a new beta service called Play.
Play from Game Salute.
Right. So let's say, you know, everybody knows how Xbox achievements work, right? So this is the same sort of thing, except for playing your miniature board games. So you go in there, there's little icons for every single game. They're starting to add them now that's a beta, so there's a few, but they're adding more as they go. And you can sign up. If your store signs up, then you can start playing games, recording plays, getting bonuses, special achievements for if your store runs a tournament, you play in that tournament, you get an achievement for that. So they just kind of rack up all these points. They support special prizes for certain play events. It's really interesting. So if you want to check out the latest in gaming, sort of fun ways to interact with your friends and keep track
check
of what
out
you're playing.
Play at www.gamesloot.com/play.
Right. And don't forget to ask your store to sign up for Play as well so they can start participating in the cool project too.
That's Play.
Thank you, Craig.
Oh, my God.
This is the Inner Sphere. Thousands of planets colonized by humankind. Once it was united under the Star League. But for the last 300 years, it has been consumed by savage wars. Until a new enemy appeared. Mysterious invaders known as the Clans. Powerful and ruthless, they struck like lightning, attacking every sector at once. But they made one big mistake. They attacked my home planet. Now in the spirit of the Star League, ancient enemies have reunited. And we're gonna take back our galaxy.
Ooh, baby. We're gonna take back our galaxy, boys. We're taking it back.
80s cartoons.
Oh, yes, they're awesome. 80s
I've never
cartoons,
heard of that before.
80s cartoons with really, really, really bad CGI. Quick, remember that part, Craig? Quick, go to scanner mode. It would cut over to, like, really bad CGI jacks of mech warriors, like, little tiny arms that just, like, fall off. And it's awesome. Yeah. Oh, it's old school.
It was old school. That's one thing. That's one thing you can say about it.
So it's time now to talk about Battletech. Now, since we interviewed our friends over there at Catalyst Game Labs, who are the current guys who do the whole Battletech thing, we've had lots and lots of emails saying, when are you guys going to talk about Battletech? So I thought it'd be fun to talk about Battletech, especially since I jumped back in right after that as well and reviewed the whole game system and looked at the options. But this is going to be a little different than our normal reviews. Instead of trying to review Battletech, which is really more of a universe than it is a game, I thought it'd be kind of fun to do to do what they call it, what the English say, is a primer, right?
Oh, it is indeed a primer.
A little primer on the whole idea of Battletech, and then how you might get started, and some very basics of the game to get you kind of a feel for, is it the kind of thing you might be interested in?
Exactly. Unschooled colonials might call it a primer.
A primer as well, yes, for those Americans.
That's what I call it.
A primer. So let's start talking about Battletech. What the heck is it? In case you missed that show where we interviewed Randall from Catalyst Game Labs, let's talk a little about it. So Battletech as a game has been around for ever.
A very, very, very long time.
In fact, it would be 25 years as the 25th anniversary edition just came out.
Yes, indeed.
And there are many, many, many variants of Battletech. There's so many different flavors of it. But basically, it started the very first one came out in 1984 by a company called FASA, F-A-S-A.
Battle Droids.
And it was originally under the moniker Battle Droids until some guy named George Lucas called him up and said, excuse me, I own the rights to droids and all forms of droid. So they had to change it, and they changed it to the word
mech. There'll be no droids here today.
Right. So they changed it to the word mech, which I think is a lot cooler than droid for this purpose. Now, don't get me wrong, I love R2, but we're talking giant robots with guns on them. That's not a droid, that's a mech.
Yeah.
And now, Battletech initially took a lot of their interesting designs and the shapes of their giant robots. And in Battletech, the whole thing about the game is, You're piloting, you're a mech warrior, a pilot of a giant, like, what, 50-foot tall robot?
30
feet tall robot?
It's always, no matter how, that's one of my problems with this universe.
It's always
no
30 feet tall.
How big and heavy it's supposed to be, they're always 30 feet tall.
Now, so the initial game, the very first box that came out, and all the mech designs that were inside of it, all came from anime. Mostly from the Macross Robotech saga, okay? And this is what drew a lot of people, too, because it's like, cool, you get to... And they had, if you remember, they called them lands, but they were the mechs that could actually transform from the legs hanging down to a jet to the... Just like in Robotech. They had the Warhammer mech from the front of the box was actually one of the ones from Macross.
The Shadowhawk.
And they got into trouble because, well, the guys that do the anime stuff are like, hey, hello, those... So again, someone called them and said, those are ours, we'd like to have that. So anyway, they came up with their own new designs, and after that, it's been sort of standard. And over all that time, FASA controlled it for most of the time, but eventually FASA died in the late 90s. And
so wait, I'm confused. Yep. So Robotech is a different property than Battletech?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Robotech
is.
Yeah, Robotech
is Robotech just a cartoon?
Well, some people would send emails to you if you said that. But yes, it is a saga. Like Star Wars is just a movie. Robotech is just a cartoon, yes.
Oh, okay.
I meant to say
that it's not a game as well.
Well, I think there are Robotech RPGs and other things that have spun off from it, but that's a separate
license.
Battletech. Right. So what happened was they were using Robotech IP without license inside of Battletech, and they had to stop. So
okay.
Now there are Robotech. There are Robotech games and all that, but Battletech is a separate thing.
Okay, so Catalyst Games is Battletech.
Yes, yes. Okay. Catalyst Game Labs has some people, as we talked to Randall, who were formerly at FASA and have been involved forever, and now Catalyst Games owns the license to Battletech and Shadowrun and some other things as well.
Just for your information, there's a lot of Robotech video games.
Oh, yes, tons of video games for Robotech as well.
Fact,
I had one of the Xbox ones.
The good. Xbox seems to be very well represented.
Yes, indeed.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Now,
Nintendo.
So Battletech's always been sort of billed as a board game. It comes in a box, and it has a board in there. It used to be paperish, and then it became sort of cardstocky. Nowadays, it's actually a board game quality board. And there were a bunch of expansions, all with the word tech after them. So eventually there was City Tech, which added the rules to fight inside tall buildings and everything. And then there was Aero Tech, which added planes and space. And these come out in different boxes. And then also you see lots of books called technical readouts. And these are sort of strange. What are the forms for those books, Craig? They're sort of longer than they are tall. They're sort of sideways books.
I don't know what the type of paper is called, but it is it's a short, squat, long kind of data, almost like a Jane's book.
Yes,
you flip through it, and they have wire diagrams rather than illustrations, and they've got all the specs on a bunch of different types of mechs for each book.
Right. So the technical readouts come out with all kinds of new mechs, and the interesting thing about Battletech has always been there's full rules in the game for creating your own mechs, and so you can build your own from the ground up. You can take one and make a variant. And then these technical readouts include many, many more things for the game, not just mechs either. They had tanks and infantry and battle suits and all kinds of craziness. So it's a very, very well-rounded, fully supported universe that covers just about every form of combat you can imagine in the far future.
Right.
And there is tons. It's been around so long and so represented. As you heard, there's a Saturday morning cartoon. There are tons and tons of novels. There are plenty of books about the game itself. There have been many video games. In fact, little bit of trivia, the very, very first Xbox Live game, one of the most popular, was MechWarrior. Even the Clix game from WizKids, MechWarrior Clix, is also based in the Battletech universe as well. So lots of variants, lots of flavors. And before we get started into ways you can buy stuff, there's also been a lot of background material and fluff.
Lots.
Around the universe, and it's very well known amongst people who follow this sort of thing. So, Craig, can you give us a very short but insightful primer?
Sure. But concise.
Into the fluff of the Battletech universe. What's this whole thing about clans and Intersphere and all that stuff?
Okay, well, what you've got is, first of all, about 350 years ago from the now that most people fight in, although really hardcore Battletech fans actually, they'll actually play as if it's a historical war game, so they play by decade, and they figure out what decade they're in and what technology they have in that decade, but... general now of the plot line before it goes off, because it goes off another 200 years into the future now also. But in the most of the novels take place in this timeline where you've got the canon historical. What happened was 300 years ago you had the Star League, and the Star League was the entire galaxy, and it was under the control of one entity, the Star League, and the Star League was under the control of one guy called the First Lord. And it was basically like a big feudal system, and there were many great houses, and the First Lord was the lord that was like first among equals in charge of the whole thing, and he lived on Earth, which they called Terra. A lot of that going around. And
figure.
Yeah. And so what happened was you had this guy called Stefan Amaris, or Amaris, and he was a usurper. So he killed the First Lord, and he took over in this time of upheaval. And all of the houses were like, well, hey, you're not a First Lord. We're not going to listen to you. So all of the houses started fighting amongst themselves, and they killed Stefan Amaris. And so you had basically the breakdown of what emerged was five major houses. And those would very quickly be the Compellan Confederation, which is basically Chinese. They kind of follow cultural templates a little bit. You have the Draconis Combine, which is the Compellan Confederation is small and kind of rinky. Mm-hmm. The Draconis Combine is huge. It's Japanese, feudal Japanese, very cool stuff. You have the Federated Sons, which are kind of like England, America, kind of Canada, kind of combo. Then you have the Liren Commonwealth, which is sort of the rest of Western Europe, focusing mainly on Germany. And then you have the Free Worlds League, which doesn't really fit in any of that because it's like all broken up into little areas that all don't always get along, and they don't have like a lord. And these are all feudal again. So they're all ruled by families that, you know, pass down their rights. And then what happened was they're all fighting amongst themselves and everybody wants to be the first lord. So for 300 years, they're fighting with these giant battle mechs that they've lost the technology to build cooler, newer, advanced ones. So all they're doing is messing with the pieces and rearranging them sometimes. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, the army of the Star League fled because they didn't want to be used as a pawn. So they fled. Nicholas Kerensky was the guy in charge of the whole army. And he was like, you know what? We're going to leave. And when we come back, we're going to assume that everything is fine or we're just not coming back. So the whole Star League army leaves the Inner Sphere completely, which right. is what all these star systems are called. So then 300 years later, all of the outlying planets out towards this one particular peripheral area all get attacked at the same time. And everybody's like, oh, my God, are they aliens? What are they? Is the army coming back to wipe us all out? And they're called the Clans, which are, in fact, the descendants of the army that fled. But they've since, you know, they've had 300 years of social evolution also, and they've split into different factions. And the two main factions are the Wardens, who want to guard the Inner Sphere from any other outside dangers but don't want to interfere. And then there's the Crusaders, who think it's their job to come in and force the rest of the Inner Sphere to be one entity again under them, basically, and they'll take over Terra. So that's the basic plot line of the main arcing story.
Right.
So one thing I've always wondered, and I realize this may jam us up here on time, but do these have game mechanic effects, or is this just the history?
Oh, no.
Oh, there's all kinds of the technology. If you play Clans, your technology is way better.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Your infantry can actually take out a mech, which if you're anybody else, their infantry can't, unless you go forward in the timeline.
And is Clans an army list choice, or is it a
There's many different clans, and the key technical difference for the Clans are that they use something called an omni mech.
Right.
All the Inner Sphere mechs are they're like Shadowhawk is a Shadowhawk is a Shadowhawk, a Marauder is a Marauder is a Marauder. They're all built the same way. They've got the same arms. They've got the same weapons. They've got the same heat sinks. They've got the same systems.
There's slight variants, but they're basically the same.
Right.
Okay. Yeah.
An Omni-Mech is a body type, and then you plug the arms and the other weapon systems into it as you need.
Right.
Okay.
So they're much more versatile. Their weapons
based
are
on your clan?
Powerful. They have better range. What?
Well, yeah. Based on your clan?
No, all the clans are pretty much using the same technology they haven't been pummeling each other, so their technology hasn't been degraded.
And also,
since the time of the Inner,
and
since
also,
the time of the Star League,
Battletech's. You don't build armies in Battletech like you do in a miniature war game. You do pick what you want to have, and there are mechs and chassis and variants that are preferred by certain factions, but there's not like, this is the House Karita faction list, and this is the, you know what I mean? Like, it's more, if you're Karita, you probably lean towards these mechs, but they also might have, salvage is a big part of the universe. You're always picking up old mechs, so it's very, very fluffy and likely that any mech could be in any house. And as Craig said, because the clan mechs are so interchangeable, there's not even really a particular clan. The big differentiator is clan versus Inner Sphere is the biggest differentiator, because Inner Sphere probably wouldn't have a lot of clan mech technology, you know,
right.
Except unless you talk away in the future. And also, okay. Raef, it is very much like a historical war game, because those technical readouts I mentioned, as Craig pointed out, they all pick different timelines. So when you play your game, of course, you can pick anything you want and just play whatever you like, but usually people will pick a time period and say, and the big differentiator is, are we playing pre-clan or post-clan, and then what's going on in there. So if you play pre-clan and use a certain technical readout, you only have the materials in that technical readout and before, and that kind of thing. So it's similar to Flames of War in that respect, where the time period you pick is going to dictate the options you have.
Oh, okay.
Which is kind of neat. So if you're listening to all this and you're like, wow, piloting, you know, 30-foot-tall giant steel mechs of 100 tons and beating each other up, all these crazy clans, sounds pretty cool. How do you get started? Well, that's a good question. And
yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
Fortunately, the folks at Catalyst Game Labs have made it very easy now with the brand new 25th anniversary starter set.
Okay.
Conveniently priced at only $50. 50 bucks. Now, what comes in this box, it's actually a nice deep box about the size of a square board game box, you know, you might find for...
I've seen it. Good box.
Yeah, it's a good box. Nice and shiny, very glossy. And inside this thing is tons of stuff. Yeah. You get 24... Now, if you're a miniature war gamer, these look like pretty much very, very old school plastics. 24 ready-to-play plastic battle mechs, they call them, but they're not painted anywhere. They're just gray molds. The detail is okay. I'd say if you're looking at this as a board game, the detail is average. if you're looking at it as a miniature war game, the detail is not so hot. They also include in here two what they call premium quality. These are sort of like the previews of where they'd like to go and making new mechs. And these actually are a little bit nicer, Craig. What, did you agree that the two newer ones are kind of cooler?
The new ones are much nicer.
Yeah, so the new ones are almost miniature wargaming quality. They're not like the highest end ones, but they're average for today. But if you think of it more as a board game, unless it's a miniature war game, I think you'd be more satisfied with what you get in the box. You do get a quick start rule book, which is very handy. So you grab everything. By the way, all the books I'm describing in here are all full color, very glossy, nice layout, table of contents. They are all, they're like the folded bound with the staples in them. So they have like, you know, a thick cover, but they're not like book books. They're more like booklets. Right. Yeah. But they're all very meaty and well written and well edited. The game's been around a long time, and you can tell they've been refining it over those years. So you get a quick start book, which is great. Tells you exactly what to play. Very, very simple rules. They're light and fast. Then you get a 36-page book of pre-made Battletech record sheets. Okay, so now in the olden days, back when I used to play this as a boy, we'd have to photocopy these things somehow to play over and over again, or laminate them somehow. But of course, nowadays you can also download them as a free PDF and just print them as many times as you like, which makes it a lot easier. Because what's going to happen is on these sheets you're going to color in or scribble on them and mark out which parts of your mech get damaged. That's why you need these big books, because these sheets for each mech are very, very detailed. There's a lot of information. Each mech has its own distinct, unique critical hit table. Each mech has its own heat track that varies from other mechs. They have their own weapons lists. Every weapon on that mech could be different than any other mech. The full specs for every weapon on that mech are on the mech. There are the hit locations are all unique to the mech in terms of how many points of armor there are, internal structure points, all that stuff's on each of these sheets. So each mech is literally is 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper, is chock full of everything you need to play one mech. So
that's what I remember.
So that's part of the details. You also get a nice 80-page full color book, and I'll get into the difference in these books in a minute here. And then you get it. This is a nice little addition. It's called The Inner Sphere at a Glance, and it's a 56-page full-color fluff book. That's all it is.
Oh.
And it just covers all the different houses that Craig kind of hinted at, talks about the clans a little bit, and gives you fluff and some color pictures of all the major mechs that are included in this game.
Oh, I like that.
Which is nice, too, yeah. So with this one purchase, you're going to have a good feeling of the entire Battletech universe. What I also was really happy to see is you get two almost linen, they're linen actually, Cook reference cards. They're 8.5 by 11, really solid, nice looking things. And then you also get really, really nice 18 by 24 inch game boards, two of them. And they're nice board game quality boards. I remember playing on old paper mats in the old days. So that's really nice as well. So yeah, I think the starter box is great for what you get. There's two basic core rules. And Craig, you got a chance to look in the starter box. Did you feel like it was a pretty good value for $50?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, The key is don't go in thinking that you're getting what's going to end up being your mechs that you're going to want to use for a long time.
Right.
You're going to want to get you're going to want to buy the individual models eventually, because most people aren't. If you're a war, I should put it that another. If you're a war gamer, you're going to want to get the more detailed models.
Right. If you're a board gamer, I mean, you're fine with what you
then
get.
Then you're already good.
And it's better than what I used to get, because back when I got my Battletech set, it didn't even come with models. It came with cardboard paper, double you folded in half.
Yeah.
And it had a color front and back picture of a mech, and you put it in one of those little plastic stands. You know, like remember old board games? So that was how you used to play. Battletech was on a paper mat with paper mechs inside little plastic stands. So if you think about where that was back in the 80s and where it is today, that's a huge improvement, because now you're dealing with plastic miniatures. And you do get 24. That's a pretty good variety of mechs, you know, and they're all different. There's not like three of each kind. They're all different unique mechs.
Now, wait a minute. You can get these as separate blisters?
There are different. Now, I don't think Catalyst actually makes the miniatures. I mean, they make the box. But there are companies that they work with. And if you go to, and I'll mention this several times, if you go to classicbattletech.com, okay, that's a website with everything you need to know about Battletech. And they link to all these different manufacturers that make the mechs. And they have a licensing deal with some of the miniature manufacturers that make different mechs. But there are very, very nice metal mechs for the game. But they're also very expensive. Well, I say very. They're about $15 to $20 per mech.
Right.
Okay. So that's, you know, they're medium size. Medium's probably, they're not quite as big as a medium, war beast in War Machine, but
no, they're closer to like a large,
closer to a large infantry
model in 40K, or
kind of like a Grey Knight.
They're a little bigger than a Terminator, so the price point's a little high for what you get.
Yeah.
But again, if you're a hardcore Battletech fan, you want to slowly collect them, you know, you can get them one at a time once a week, and it's not too bad. But there's an option. But Catalyst, if you ask Randall when he mentioned that, they think of this as a board game. There are miniature game options, but to them, this is a board game. So and for $50, you got a really nice game with a lot of depth to it. You know, now in the starter set, you got basically two ways you can play the game. There's the simple, basic way, and then there's the full version of Battletech. Okay, so I think the quick start rules, though, don't be fooled. This is a solid quick start game. And just so you know, if you go to, again, classicbattletech.com, and you look on the left-hand side of the screen there, it says, how do I get started playing Battletech? And there's all these free PDFs. And one of the free PDFs is the quick start rulebook you get in this box. So if you're, it's kind of like any other board game, like Fantasy Flight, right? If you're not sure about the rules, hey, go download the free PDF, check it out, see what you think.
Yeah, right.
The quick reference sheets are much more simplified. One thing, for example, that Battletech players will know is heat is a big deal. In the quick game, there's no heat.
That's what I remember.
There's no heat at all in the quick game. There's no critical hit locations. There's just armor damage, and once you get through the armor, that system is down. It's much simpler, but even in this quick start game, it still handles not just mechs, it handles vehicles and troops. There's some nice simple scenarios that take you through different levels of the mech. And there are, so again, simple little color mech sheets just to get started with. So it's actually a nice little game way to get started. And what's nice about this is every rule you learn in the quick start game is one of the rules in the main game. They just add more between them.
Yeah.
So it's not like you're playing a different game. You're playing Battletech with just less elements of it. And I'll kind of explain that in a bit. So what do you need to learn? Here's what's going to happen in the basic game, right, when you get to play. Yeah. You're going to learn about initiative. And so what happens is basically, here's what happens. You roll for initiative. Each player rolls. You roll two dice, and the higher roller is the winner of initiative. There's an integrated movement system in Battletech, okay, but each turn's not fully integrated. So what I mean by that. So first there's the movement phase, and the loser of initiative has to move one of his units, usually one mech, first. So I will pick one of my mechs, and I will move him, okay? And then my opponent, Raef, gets to pick one of his mechs and move it. And now it's my turn again. I've got to move another one on my max. And we go back and forth until we moved all of our stuff. Okay?
Okay.
So it's that integrated thing. But the thing about this is sort of is because we're integrated moving, but we're not shooting yet. Okay? Shooting comes later.
Oh.
Okay? This is sort of like the way Call to Arms used to be, right? So you go back and forth moving. Then there's integrated attacks. Now this is the part where it gets a little hairy because, so what happens is if I've lost initiative, I have to declare my attack first. And I declare, I don't resolve it. I just say, this mech here is going to shoot your other mech over there, Raef. And Raef says, okay, well, my mech B is going to shoot your mech C. And I'm saying, okay, why is the mech C going to shoot back? And we declare all of our attacks before we roll anything, okay?
Yeah.
And then we resolve the attacks, do damage, and poof, our turn's over. And we repeat, okay? That's really the game. I'll get into the details of those in just a second. So, and when you're keeping track of all this, you're going to be using each mech's got its own sheet, kind of like War Machine has its own cards. But these are, as I mentioned before, these are much bigger. In the quick start game, they're about a half a sheet big. And then in the full game, it's just more so. You got your basic stats, like your how many movement points it is to walk, how many movement points it is to run, the tonnage of your mech, i.e. the size. Tonnage is sort of used as the game balancing game in this game. Yeah. Sort of like points, but not really, but kind of is. I think later, initially I think it was the only way to balance, but later they added a point system. And it also lists all the weapons on your mechs and their locations. And locations are important because when shots hit, they hit certain parts of your mech. So it'll say, like, you have a rocket, LRM-10, which stands for long-range missile launcher with 10 missile pods in it. And it'll say, like, you know, LT for left torso. So yeah. Your mech has got really a bunch of locations. It's got two legs, two arms, a torso, but a torso is divided into three sections, a left torso, right torso, and a center torso, and then here's your head, okay? And when you shoot at things, you randomly determine where those are, and those sections get blown up. Whatever's located there, whatever weapon is there, is going to go offline. All right, so that's what's on your sheet. Basically, your weapons and your tonnage and how much you move, and then your pilot skill. But in the basic game, pilot skills are all the same. Okay,
yeah.
So how do you move? Moving is really simple. I don't know if we mentioned this, but the game board is entirely a hex-based board. Okay,
yes.
So there's no measuring or anything else. You're on a game board, bunch of hexes, and all you do is you say you have to declare whether my mech's going to walk or run. There's actually several different movement modes in the advanced game. And then if you're walking, he's got so many movement points. If you're running, he's got more movement points. And you just spend that many movement points to move. But it's not quite as simple as just one square per movement point, right? So the first thing to worry about is, are you walking into any kind of weird terrain, right? If you're walking into a forest, it might cost two movement points to enter that. And there's a nice big table that explains all that stuff in the game. Yeah. But also, facing is a huge deal in Battletech. Okay?
Oh, yeah.
So you got to keep your miniature facing one of the edges of your hex. And to change facing, i.e. to rotate one space to the left or the right, costs a movement point.
Yep.
So you need to keep track of your movement. Now, in the basic game, Firing arcs are very, very simple. It's just forward of your mech, and it's a little diagram that goes out in like sort of a V extending out from your spot. But in the advanced Battletech game, where the weapon is on your body dictates its firing arc. So in other words, your right arm can actually go back behind and kind of almost get to the rear, you know, almost like 180 degrees to the side, while weapons on your torso can only fire forward, that kind of thing. And there's even some mechs with rear-mounted weapons as well. So you've got, it's almost like playing in with ships in a sea game where you've got these different firing arcs that change as you move, and you got to keep track of all that stuff. Now, also, in the quick start basic game, there's no torso twisting. What do I mean by torso twisting, Raef?
Well, I would think it would mean that the legs are pointed one way and the torso is painted pointed another for firing.
Exactly right, right? So in the advanced game, you actually have to have a marker down next to your mech on this on the hex showing which way his torso is facing and which way his feet are facing. So think of a tank and a tank turret. Your tank turret might be shooting backwards, but your tank's going forwards. Well, your mech could be walking to the left while your torso is pinning to the right, which changes all your firing arcs. In the basic game, you don't have to worry about that. But in the advanced game, yeah, you can torso twist. And you can actually be running circles around a guy with your feet while you're constantly facing at him directly with your torso. So as you're starting to see here, as you move up into levels of depth in Battletech, there's a lot going on with this, just with one model, right? Now, combat. So that's moving. Moving's pretty simple, actually. Even in the advanced game, it's not that hard. But you're just basically picking, am I walking or running? How many moon points do I have? What am I walking through? And how much facing changes am I going to make? Yeah. Boom, I'm done moving.
Now, does running, how does that, like, what else can you do? What other effects does that have on your model declare that they're running?
Well, so in the quick start rules, remember, there's no heat.
Right.
But in the advanced rules, running certain actions, certain movement types like running, generate extra heat. Uh-huh. And heat is a huge deal. We'll talk more about heat a little later because there's none in the quick start game. So, was that what you're thinking of? Oh, well, it's also modifiers to hit and stuff. We'll get to that in a minute also. Right. So how far you move affects your own ability to shoot, but also how far your target moves also affects your ability to shoot.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. It gets complicated.
It does. There's a lot going on. But again, what's nice is, though, there's this nice big heavy quick reference card, and if you look at that, it sort of lists everything to worry about. And so even if you haven't memorized, oh, walking makes me harder to shoot, the first time you do it in the game and you look at the chart of all the mods, you go, oh, crap, I'm minus two because I walked. I'll remember that next time. And a few times you'll memorize. You'll get it down. And it actually is common sense, right? If I stand still, I'm more accurate than if I move, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Now, combat. Now, in the quick game, quick start game, there's no hand-to-hand or melee combat. What's the correct pronunciation of
melee?
Thank you, melee. Thank you. Yeah. I keep calling it melee like the worms, and I get emails, so.
Yeah,
thank you.
Like the melee. Worms.
Yeah, melee worms. Melee worms, right. And they're called that because if you watch them carefully, they constantly go to battle with each other with sword and shield. It's kind of funny. yes. Little facts.
Yeah, I never caught that before.
Facts that are not true. So here we go. Combat. So all you do with combat, again, the game, it's kind of funny about this game. The rules aren't that complicated. There's just a lot of little rules, okay? So combat. You just verify, are you within range? Now, here's one of the interesting things about Battletech. So when you look at your mech's sheet, okay, and this is what I do like. There's not a lot. You don't have to go to the books a lot, because if you have your mech's sheet and you have that nice quick reference card, you kind of have everything you need to figure everything out. So you look at your mech's sheet. It says, okay, I've got that LRM-10, right? And now, actually, let me look at a real mech. Let me just grab a mech here out of my mech.
Yeah, why don't you grab a mech?
Let's see who I've got here. Let's see. I'm trying to find an advanced one here. It's a little more exciting. Okay, here we go. Oh, look, I've got an ENF-4R Enforcer. Now, the Enforcer is armed with an autocannon 10 in his right arm. That sounds pretty cool. Autocannons, by the way, and there's tons of different weapons in the game, and in these technical readouts, they really kind of explain the fluff behind each weapon. An autocannon is like a big, is there classic guns that use ammunition, okay?
Yeah.
And yes, you do track ammunition in Battletech. So if a weapon uses ammunition, you got to mark it off every time you shoot it, and there's a certain number of rounds in there, and you'll run out.
Which is an excellent reason to take an all-energy weapon mech until you figure out.
Well, here's the nice thing. The Enforcer, for example, has an autocannon 10 in his right arm, but then he also has a large laser in his left arm and a small laser in his left torso, so he's got backup. Now, if you look at the autocannon 10, it tells me that I have a short range of 5, a medium range of 10, and a long range of 15. But if you look at my small laser, short range is 1, medium range is 2, and long range is 3. So what's interesting about this game is, in many of the more simplified miniature war games you play today, right, ranges are fixed for the game, you know, X number of inches is short, and then the rest is long. Well, this game, it's weapon-specific. So an autocannon's short range is 5, while a small laser short range is only 1. Now, the range is important because, you can't shoot past your longest range, and those numbers are right off right there. That's in hexes, right? So short range of 5 means if you're doing 5 hexes of me, I can hit you at short range of my autocannon.
So how are you trying to distinguish that from a miniature game?
Oh, because in a miniature game, right, what's I'm thinking of actually, there's not too many that use. Well, I'm thinking more of Dystopian Wars, right? Range bands are flat, regardless of which weapon you're using, right?
Yeah,
I think Flames of War have different ranges for different weapons.
Yes.
Okay. So, but if different range bands, like short and long, it does.
No.
It? No. Okay. So this game, though, they're different for each weapon class, right? So. Right. So
this is like a call back to if people have been playing GW for a long time. This is it's like a parallel evolution.
Yeah. Yep.
This is where both of these games came from, that era where they wanted all that
more,
you know,
crunch
that
was better.
Fuchsia.
Right. More crunch was better. So you've got these ranges, right? So I count up that many squares. Now all the ranges do is they have modifiers. So short range is no modifiers to hit. Medium range is +2, and long range is +4. The great thing is, this is all in your Mexico reference sheet. So all that stuff, I didn't have to look in the rule book. I'm looking at my mech sheet. Oh, it's all right there. There's the ranges and the modifiers, so I'm figuring things out what I'm going to do. It's all right there in front of me. I don't have to look anything up. That's pretty nice. And this is, again, the simple card I'm looking at right now.
Right.
Now, so all I do is I make sure I'm in the range of my opponent. I'm going to verify I have line of sight. That's pretty simple. You draw a line from the center of the hex to your center of the hex. Any hex you go through, you look at what's there. You look, check the rules. If it's a tree, it's a modifier. If it's like a rock, you can't see through it, that kind of thing. You just figure it out. And what's nice is because they actually also have packs of different hex boards you can buy with different terrain configurations on there. Of course, you could also use different hexes that you can move around on there, all kinds of counters, whatever you like. Now, once you're going to shoot. So I've declared my weapon. I'm going to fire my autocannon 10 at Raef. I'm going to roll 2d6, and I'm trying to equal or beat in the basic game. The base to hit number is always 4. Okay. Yep. That sounds pretty easy, right? I got to beat 4 on 2d6. Well, I'm going to hit you all the time. But there are tons of modifiers in this game.
Oh.
Okay.
So think about it. It gets hard pretty quick.
Think about range. I'm shooting long range. I'm already at +4 to hit. So now I've got to roll above an 8 or higher. If I moved at all, there's pluses and minuses for that. Let's see. Let's check out some movement modifiers here. Let's see. Movement to hit rolls. If I moved, it's +2. So things like that. So it depends how far my target roof. So it's all these book modifiers that come in there and make it harder to hit. Okay. If I equal or exceed, if I'm lower than that, if I roll lower, I miss. Boop. That's it. I mark off the ammo if I had to use any ammo. And also, advanced game, if I'm firing energy weapons, remember Craig said, oh, I want an all energy mech, so I don't have to worry about ammo. Yes, but in the advanced game, energy weapons generate heat, whereas ammo-based weapons usually don't.
Uh-huh.
So it's a trade-off, right? The autocannon got to worry about ammo, but doesn't overheat my mech. A giant laser that does similar damage to the autocannon might generate 5 or 6 heat per shot, which could be very expensive. More about heat later. So that's pretty much it. You're rolling hit. Now, after you hit the guy, though, you got to roll location. Now, here's an interesting thing about this game. Damage per weapon is always fixed, okay? There's no die roll involved in how much damage I do. So, for example, that autocannon 10 does 10 points of damage. That small laser on my mech, 3 points of damage, and again, that's right on my mech card, okay? So it's all right there. So that's great. That's easy to do. All you get, the last little random thing, though, is where do I hit your mech? And this reminds me of the old-school D&D games. Remember the old critical hit charts in Dragon Magazine? I just remember that. Mm-hmm. It was like, oh, I hit you in the head with my +4 Holy Avenger. Well, this is sort of the same deal. So right there on my mech sheet, again, is a little hit location chart. So I would say, Raef, roll 2d6 and tell me what you get. What'd you get, Raef?
12.
12, a headshot! Okay, so you hit me in the head.
Cheater.
So nice. I look at my little sheet. Now, there's also a little diagram of my mech there with little lines for areas. Looks like a little thing. And there's little circles like on the SAT in each area. And there's circles in the head, and there's circles in each torso section. And I just, if I hit Raef with my autocannon 10, he's going to color in 10 circles whatever location I hit him in.
Yeah.
Now, in the basic game, there's only circles for armor, and that's all there is. So as soon as all the circles are colored in for that section, that section's now offline, and any additional circles transfer to the next section in. Yeah. And there's even a little diagram there that shows you where the arrows go. Now, there's certain sections that are worse to get knocked off than others. For example, getting the head knocked out is bad. Your center torso being removed is also
that's
bad.
That's where you're sitting.
Right.
I'm sitting in the chest plate area.
And in the advanced game, there's critical hits, which I'll get to a little later. So that's pretty much it. It's just to color it off, and then you keep on playing. And again, though, if I lose my large laser's in my left arm. So if Raef blew off my left arm, there goes my large laser. Boof, gone.
Yeah.
That's the basic game in a nutshell. Now, what's nice, too, in there, though, even though it's a basic game, there are 4, I think, different scenarios in there that kind of add levels of complexity. Some of them add infantry and things like that. So there's a nice little game there, that basic game, and there's still some fun things to do in there. But for your $50, you get a lot more than that. Oh, no, it's not done yet. So we also have... let's move on to the advanced book. So what does the advanced book add to the game? I'm just going to kind of go over everything real quick. Yeah. First and foremost, and most importantly, it adds heat. So if you look at the very first thing you do, and again, this is available online as a PDF for free also if you go to their site, these mech sheets, you can actually see the difference between a basic mech sheet and then the advanced mech sheet, which is a couple of pages later. And the advanced mech sheets add, I think I mentioned this, a huge critical hit table that shows up. How does critical hits work? Well, on the advanced mech sheet also, you'll notice there's actually two diagrams of your mech. Actually, there's really three if you think about it. There's one front view diagram of your mech. Then there's a smaller back view of just your center torso, because in the advanced game, your back armor on your center torso is less than your front armor on your torso. I don't mean center, I mean all three torsos. So what that means is, just like a tank in World War II, if you can shoot a mech in the back, you're in better shape than if you shoot him from the front. This, again, makes facing and torso twisting a huge part of the game. Because these mechs are rocking around, like if you get to like a heavy mech, just for giving an idea here, let's see. Let me zip up to like a grasshopper's only a medium. Let me go up to, well, let's get to somebody a little heavier here. Let's see. Ooh, look at this guy. How about a Thor Prime? Look at him there. He's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. He's rocking like 27 armor in his center torso, okay,
that's
in the front.
A lot of armor.
But on the back, he's rocking 1, 2, 3, 4, 8 armor on the back center. And remember, center torso's gone. Bad news. So now, what's interesting about this, though, is after you get through the armor, then there's another whole diagram of your mech, and that represents the structure points under that armor, okay? And so any extra damage after I blast your armor, if I shoot you again, that's where you have no armor now, now you got to start taking points on the structure. So what's interesting in the advanced game is your arm's not immediately gone when the armor's melted off. All that happens is now you're taking structure hits, okay? Now, when the structure's all gone, then the arm is lost. But it's worse than that. Every time you take a hit to structure, you got to roll on the critical hit table, okay? And there's a separate critical hit table for each section of the mech, okay? And again, this is per sheet, and they're different for every mech. So, like, for example, on this Thor Prime here, who's armed with a PPC. Craig, what is a PPC?
That would be a particle projection cannon.
It is. Big arse cannon that shoots giant energy beams.
Lightning.
This is actually one of the advanced ER PPCs. And if you look at his right arm, he carries a PPC, by the way, in his right arm. If you look at his right arm.
Extended range, by the way.
Thank you, yes. If you look at his right arm, his criticals show shoulder, upper arm actuator, and then he's got two slots that list ER-PPC, ER-PPC. And then below that, he's got this ferrofibrous and other things. And there's a bunch of roll-agains, depending on what you roll. So what happens is, where you get your critical affects the mech in different ways, and the rulebook covers all this. If you get hit in the center torso, you can get hit in your gyros, make it harder to stand up and for all your piloting tests. There's your jump jets. This mech's got jump jets that can fly. You get hit there in your center torso. So it's really cool because any place you get hit has different effects on the mech. And what happens is because the hit locations you get hit in are more or less likely depending on your facing, you can actually screen. Like if he punches through my back with a lucky shot from a jump jet mech, I can try to change my facing to protect my back and keep my armor more to the front.
Yeah.
Which is nice. So that's one of the big things. So the other big thing they add is heat. And as Craig mentioned before, many, many things you do in this game generate heat.
It's huge.
The faster you move generate heat, like running. Different weapons, mostly energy weapons, generate heat. And when you generate heat, there's a little heat track on your sheet. And you just kind of mark it off with pencil how high you're going on the heat track. And your mech also has some number of heat sinks. Okay. And that number is also on your sheet. And the number of heat sinks you had tells you how much heat's going to reduce each turn, how much heat you're going to get back, basically, how you get to throw off your mech. And there's cute little rules, like if you're standing in water, you cool faster, things like that. If your heat gets too high, though, there's a little heat table here that shows bad things that happen. Like, for example, if I'm at 10 heat in my Thor Prime, I have -2 movement points. So I'm having trouble moving. If I'm at 8 heat, I'm +1 to fire, and there's chances you can catch on fire when you get hit by certain weapons. Now it's easier for me to get caught on fire.
I remember something about heat sinks.
Oh, yeah, that's what I just mentioned. So heat sinks, what they do is they reduce they remove heat points from you each turn, okay? So if I have...
But don't they get filled up or something?
Well,
or are they refreshed every turn?
Right, so what happens is there's a heat meter on the side of your mech, right? And you mark that off, and then at the end of your turn, heat goes down. Okay,
but according to your mech style, right?
According to your heat sinks, exactly. And your heat sinks are in your mech, right? So if my mech has 10 heat sinks, I would go down 10. But if my mech has 14 heat sinks, like this guy, the Thor Prime, by the way, is one of the clan mechs. So he has double heat sinks. So he's only got 14 heat sinks, but they do double. So he drops 28 heat points per turn.
Wow.
Which is pretty nice, yeah. So it's really hard for him to overheat. But other mechs, for example, don't have that ability, and they can overheat really quickly. Now, when you overheat, again, this little chart. What's really kind of funny is later as it gets higher, like, for example, if you're 28 heat level, you have an ammo, you have to avoid an ammo explosion on 8 plus, things like that. So you can really, bad things happen if you overheat. And then your mech will eventually shut down on you and just actually turn off and power down and force you to wait a couple turns to cool off.
So that's kind of what I remember is, like, from a bird's eye view, it's really a microverse within your one huge, and I want to say warjack, but it's battle mech.
Right.
That's kind of what I remembered. It was all about resource management, which was fun. I'm not saying it wasn't fun.
Yes, that's exactly right.
But it was all about, oh, do I shoot this? But if I do, it's going to give me 8 heat points. And do I turn my facing this way? Am I remembering correctly?
That's exactly right. So yes, if you got to micromanage your facing, you got to manage your heat. You can manage your style of movement, and pretty much everything you do generate heat. And then also certain enemy weapons generate heat on your mech. For example, flamethrowers or standing near a fire. And there's a lot of rules too in the advanced rules about when you hit trees with missiles that miss a guy, they'll catch the forest on fire. And if you have someone hiding in the woods, you can light the woods on fire and get him to have to move because he's.
And there's a short range missile type that actually is napalm that explodes and covers you.
Right. There's all I'm glad you brought that up, Craig. There's all kinds of missile types, so you can figure out what missile loadout you want to have in your mech and preload different ammo types in your mech. And that's part of the fun, too. Even in the basic game, even in the starter box that comes with this, the advanced rules also include, in addition to torso twisting and all that stuff, they also include building your own mech, okay? So, again, you can start the basics there. Now, it's not super advanced mech building rules in here, but there's enough. Also, there's the pilot skill comes in. Remember I said in the basic game you always hit on a 4+. Well, in the advanced game, there's piloting skill checks. So these happen all kinds of times in the game. If you take too much damage from a single volley of weapon of fire, you have to make a piloting skill check or you get knocked over. And if you try your jump jets too far, you have to make a piloting skill check. If you and also when you shoot your weapons, it's your gunnery check. So you actually have a character essentially inside your mech that has several different stats that you track. And actually there's in the advanced rules, in the full version of the game, there's campaign rules and you guys get more experience and all that craziness happens. So it's a very, very robust deep game system if you really want that for actually a pretty reasonable price.
Yeah.
So then this adds, and also the advanced rules add the hand-to-hand combat. It adds jump jets. So a lot of stuff going on in the advanced rules in this one box. And that's pretty much the core, what you get in the box, really. That's everything you get in there. You get a nice background history. You get the advanced rules and the basic rules to get started. Do you have any good memories of Battletech there, Craig?
Do I have any? Yeah, I mean, no.
No? Well, I do. My brother and I used to play Battletech like all the time, especially even when we
came back. I mean, I used to play and I enjoyed it a lot. I just, nothing has really survived all of the more
current games.
Narrative, robust games between then and now.
Well, we used to play, come home from college, and we'd play like for a whole weekend on Thanksgiving break. And we'd spend hours just building our battle groups and tweaking our mechs and then fighting it out. The game was very slow. I remember it taking like a whole day, but I remember it also being very fun and rewarding. But the biggest thing I remember, and this stays with me to this day, and I still use the term from time to time, although I'm not sure I've used it very recently, something called the chameleon effect. In the old original school version of Battletech, there was a training mech called the chameleon. And I took the chameleon and I tweaked him and I just covered the front of him with machine guns. And because as I mentioned earlier in Battletech, what happens in Battletech is the amount of damage you do is not random. And machine guns don't do very much damage, I think it's 3 points. But every shot you take on a mech has a random chance of where it's going to hit. So if you shoot a lot of bullets, there's a random chance you can hit a spot. So what happens if you get behind a mech, and he had jump jets, he flew really far. If you get behind a mech and find one chink in his armor, one spot where his armor's been reduced to zero, you want to make a lot of chameleon checks. I call it chameleon. You want to make a lot of rolls for location, because every time you get that location, even if you only do 1 point of damage, you get a critical roll to knock something important out and do an ammo explosion and blow the mech up.
Yeah.
And so I remember thinking, I want a lot of bullets. I want that chameleon effect. And we called it the chameleon effect because this one mech I made was just silly. He would just flop around. He didn't do very much damage, but as soon as there was a chink in your armor, he'd jump in there and get lucky and blow you up or do something nasty.
Yeah, fun.
Which is fun. Now, what makes the game even more crazy is what's beyond the starter box. And so I mentioned going to get what you want to look for. You go to classicbattletech.com. There's actually a PDF file on there called the Battletech Universe, and it's free. And it basically is a whole, like, 5-page pamphlet that explains all the other Battletech books.
Uh-huh.
And when I say all the other Battletech books, I mean each of these other books I'm going to describe to you is over 300 pages.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a serious game. It gets, I mean, Starfleet Battles is serious. This game is, I would say, as serious if you get all the nooks and crannies going. Okay. The first place, let's say you already have Battletech miniatures. They've been lying around forever. You haven't played in a long time, but you don't feel like you need the starter box, okay? You just want to get the latest rules. Go for Battletech Total Warfare, okay? It's hardcover version, which I think is out of print right now, but you can still get it probably some stores. It's around $30 to $40, but the PDF file is available online via classicbattletech.com, and it's only $15,
okay?
Full color, beautiful-looking book. It's got all the Battletech core rulebook, core rules. Everything I described in that basic book, plus much, 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 much more depth. Okay? Everything you need to play, plus a lot more interesting stuff. All those tours of twisting I was talking about. The advanced building rules, so you can play in a city. All that stuff's in there. Next is the what they call the tech manual. And the tech manual is the super-duper crunchy how to build your mech. Okay? So if you really want to design your own battle mechs from the ground up with all the trimmings, that's where you want to go. Okay? The next book, I mean, they're all about the same price and the same size, roughly, is Tactical Ops, okay? Now, Tactical Operations is the is sort of one step up from Total Warfare, okay? So it takes total everything in Total Warfare, the basic rules of the game, and adds even more advanced ground movement, like you can run and slide down a street, stuff like that, and skid down it. Yep. You can crawl, all kinds of crazy move. There's artillery support. There's much more overall sort of strategic stuff that happens. The real book, and this is what I actually bought next. So what I own is, well, I don't own, I have to give it away as a prize, actually. Kalos was nice enough to send us the starter box, which is what I'm looking at right now. We're going to give it away as a prize in a contest soon. Yeah. But what I did end up going out and buying was, I went out and I did a little research, and I ended up picking up the Strategic Operations book, Strategic Ops.
Yep.
It's the biggest of the bunch, 410 pages. And this book adds aerospace to the mix in a lot of ways. So aerospace operations, orbital attacks, aerospace fighters into the game, all this stuff, boom, right into the game. So you got that plus the starter box, you got pretty neat stuff. But what I really was attracted to me this was, there's three other variants on the Battletech rule system in this book. There's something called Battle Force. And Battle Force pulls the game up a level. So what I mean by that is, each hex on the game board, instead of being filled with one mech, it's filled with a unit. That is typically what, in Battletech, they call them lances. So it would be a group of, like, three mechs, or maybe five mechs, or some combined unit of tanks and mechs. And they move around as a unit, and they fire as a single volley, but it's a much more strategic sort of game. A very, imagine going up to a, like, pure board game of world conquest, basically. Then there's miniature rules in there. That's how you can actually play Battletech on a regular miniature game with no hexes board.
Yep.
And then there's my particular favorite, the quick strike rules, which sort of is a hybrid between the Battle Force rules and the miniature rules, which lets you play maybe as a single player. You could play like 10 mechs, and each mech is distilled down to a very... There's a card for each mech, but now the complexity of the mech goes from an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper to about the size of a War Machine card with just one weapon system or maybe two weapon systems, a few special rules, and a couple bonuses if you want to spend extra heat. And this is sort of the flavor that we played a few weeks ago. Yeah. That showed Craig played with us. We tried a little demo game on the Heroescape terrain. And some folks liked it, some folks didn't, but I kind of liked how you can command more than one mech with it. Because the thing about Battletech is, it's a great, as Raef mentioned, detailed game, but it's really detailed at a single... You don't want to really command more than three mechs. That's already a lot, right? But in this, you can command like several squadrons and still have a fun, fast game. But it's a different kind of game than Battletech. So that's my record. I really like Strategic Ops of the books. Then coming soon, it's not out yet, but they also have Interstellar Operations, which is basically, I think, interplanetary warfare. I mean, geez. And then there's Time of War, which is the entire Battletech RPG. We get to role play a mech warrior. And all of the stuff I just mentioned is just the tip of the iceberg, because they have all these focused books and rules about every other element of the universe. It's just a complete and total world unto itself.
Yes, it is.
So, whew. That's what I've got for Battletech. You guys got any more comments about that? That's a pretty hefty chunk of change there.
I would say that it is at least as fully realized as 40K or Fantasy or any of those game properties that have been around that long.
Right.
And the crunchiness, of course, goes way. The rules themselves go way beyond any of those games. Mm-hmm. I think it's something that definitely people should look out for if what they're looking for is a really, really crunchy, numbers-oriented, fiddly, and I don't mean that in a bad way, but I mean you manage every element of the battle as you're going forward. And if that's what you're looking for, and I know lots of people are into that. Russ, did you go with us when we went to that Carnage down in Mass?
Yes,
one year,
they had the
entire Boston waterfront for MechWarrior.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Unbelievable.
It is. And I think it speaks to the game, too. I remember Randall mentioned this to us. The rules in the game have been refined, but they are essentially unchanged after 25 years. I mean, look at something like 40K. It's been rebooted, not in a bad way. It's gotten better over time, once every 5 or 6 years, right? But this is a game where it still holds up. There's still legions of fans for this game. You know, there's still companies making money off of this core product with all kinds of expansions, and that tells you that there's something good here somewhere in the depths of it. And I like it. It's a game that you have to have the time for. And at my stage of my life, I can only play it once in a very great while. And that's kind of what I lean towards, the quick strike rules, where I can pop out and get that Battletech flavor without all the crunchiness. But I think it would be fun maybe once in a while to break out, you know, one mech each and go at it. You know, But it is a very time-intensive game if you want to get all into it and design your own mechs and figure out your exact thing. But if that's what you want to do, if you want to find a game that you can really sink your teeth into and get hours and hours and hours of entertainment for only $50 to start, that is a really good – it's probably one of the better values in gaming right now. If you think about the kind of universe and detail and depth you're going to get.
And the models. I mean, the quality of them may not be great, but you're getting a lot of models in that box.
You've got a good-looking board game for $50 here, you know, and a lot of – and a whole thing that, you know – talk about expansions. It's something you can grow into at a small price point at a time, too. You want to add all that depth I just talked about with the whole rulebook? $15 PDF. And, you know, it's funny. I used to scoff at PDFs thinking I don't want to print them out and staple them together. But now that there's e-readers, it's actually kind of nice. It's actually fun to read a full-color PDF on an iPad or a Nook Color or one of those other Galaxy Tab or whatever, because it's actually fun and it feels high-tech. It doesn't feel like you're selling for second best. You don't really miss that hardcover book as much as you might otherwise. So it's a nice way, and it's a great way to get into these games that where it's hard to find the hardcover printing now because they're harder to get now. So it's a great way to get into it. Raef, what are your thoughts? You feel inspired to try Battletech?
No, but it's not because I think it's a bad game, but it's kind of like when you ask Craig, do you have any, you know, memories of it? And I do. I think it's a little too microcosm for me, but I kind of remember back in the day I had these two neighbors that were into wargaming, and I heard them talking about this game where they played these battleship like officers, and the game was so specific you had to figure out the food intake of the sailors, like right down to the potatoes and the pasta.
That might be Harpoon.
and this game reminds me of that. If you're really kind of into, like, if you sit at movies and you're like, oh, that would never work and explosions don't make sound in space, then like this is the game for you, because you launch that cannon and it takes 8 heat. Well, you got to mark off the 8 heat, and you know, it's pretty specific, and if your torso is turned the wrong way and you want to shoot over here, well, too bad. You should have faced it the other way. And
that's a good point. But don't forget, too, the game pulls back. I mean, the quick start rules are pretty meaty, and a lot of that stuff is not in there, you know? So you can, you know, if you like your taste of Battletech, you can play it different ways. And that's like,
well, that's the thing.
That's what's really evolved with it. You know,
I think it's a great value, and it's definitely an old-school game kind of refreshed to the current. And if you're an engineer type and you're into that, like I think you can't go wrong.
Can you think of any other game out there right now that for one $50 purchase has, well, and then you want to get strategic ops, but that's three totally different ways to play, which all have the same general feeling and flavor to them,
right?
Yeah, no,
but it's like and it's way different than, you know, I play 40K and I play, you know, battle, or what do they call them, those combat squad or whatever it was,
right.
I mean, this is like different games that it scales really well.
Right,
yeah,
and
I agree.
Exactly. And you get two different games right in the basic box, because you get the quick start and then you get the full. And then, if you add strategic ops for $15 more, now you're talking $65 total. Now you've got full air combat, aerospace operations, and then the three other variants on the game. So it's really quite a nice way to start. And if you have fond memories of Battletech and haven't played it in a long time, I would definitely recommend getting back into it. And if it's something you've always been curious about, you know, hey, maybe go in with a friend, get the box, and try it out.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it's definitely probably the cheapest walk down memory lane gaming-wise you can get.
Yeah, and it's nice, too. So I think guys at Catalyst Gamers did a great job. So that's Battletech.
Yeah. And now we're not rating it? Is that the deal?
We're not really reviewing it yet. I think we have to play a little more if we wanted to review it.
Okay.
I feel bad. Well, okay, let's do it this way. Craig.
What?
In the style of an overheated mech warrior,
Jeez.
Please describe the patent-pending D6 generation rating system.
Holy crap. They got my heat sinks. Oh, I don't know. I can't think straight. D6. Oh, God. Which button is it? Oh, the lower the number, the better the rating. The higher the number, the worse the rating. Oh, a twin link means that it's a tie. Oh, I mean, it's a plus. Oh, geez, or a minus. Oh, I don't know. Eject.
All right. So
that was awesome.
That was very well done. Very well done. So we're going to rate today. We're going to do Raef ratings today. Okay. Which
I
is
think that's fair.
After looking at the box set and playing our little demo game and hearing all the how basic other rules work, what is your desire to get into the cockpit and at least try Battletech with the full on rules just once in the next couple months?
Really lowering the bar.
No, just say it. Just run it out there. Just run it there. I'll go first.
I want to go first.
Oh, you go first.
You first.
You go first.
I want to go first. You get a $100 bill at the end of the game.
Yeah, well, you can qualify however you like. How's that?
I want to go first.
You go first, Raef, because it's your style of rating system today, so it's right in there.
It's a Russ rating.
Okay.
If you're an engineer, nostalgic, crunchy type.
He's not doing it his way.
3+.
Nice. Wow, okay, good.
If you're me and there's just too many games and too little time, 6+.
Alrighty. That just cracks me up because every game is going to fall in the category. Craig, what do you got?
That's not true, because if it's awesome, then it beats it.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
I love the universe. I think it's one of the richest universes out there. I think it's right. I think it's right in there with 40K as far as the depth of it goes, and the named characters, and they're out there, and they have real established lives and a presence in the game, and I really like that. I don't like fiddly record keeping in my games anymore. In fact, I never really liked it, and now I'm old enough that and confident enough in who I am that I can just say flat out, I don't like it. It's too much like work. I would love to, you know, dip my toe in and play another one of those games that we played on the Hero Skateboard. Yep. Maybe with mechs that are all the same scale, and maybe yeah. With mechs that are slightly better or more, well matched up. But as far as getting into the cockpit on a one-on-one to try all the rules, I would like to just to see how it – like my memory is that it's so onerous that I didn't – like you would start a game – like you said, you'd spend like an hour or two making your mechs and making your lance, and it would be all exciting. Yeah. You'd start the game, and it'd be like, oh, yeah, now I move out. Oh, I don't move very fast. Oh, I shoot, but my range isn't very – and then by the time you're really slugging it out, you're like, okay, fine, you got my armor. No, wait a second while I circle in these 10 circles. And so it'd be interesting to see if, how it matches up, because it's very interesting. I think it's unique in that way that I'm really excited when I think about it, or I used to be.
Yep.
And I read all the books. I mean, I just read the first 6 books in the basic canon timeline again recently. I really liked them. They're not going to win a Pulitzer Prize, but I really, really like them, and I love the story and the intrigue and everything. So I get excited, and I get my mechs, and I picture them in my head, and I've got the models, and they're in there because I had the box that had the plastic ones, but they're still – I painted them up. I tried to make them look good, and then it just slowly grinds to a halt, the excitement as I play. So I would like to play one-on-one, maybe like with you, Russ, at some point when we have some free time, so that I could see, you know, how that's transitioned in its interaction with me in my life now, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
Yeah, that would be. Cool. So I'm not going to give it a rating as such now that I begged for it. And right. I'm just going to say that I would like to. I know this game isn't for me. I know I'm not going to like play it and then become a mech Battletech guy throw all my other stuff away. It's just more. I've really enjoyed playing Babylon 5, A Call to Arms, and circling those circles in because, you know, there were only like 10 or 12 per ship.
Right.
And that was it. And when they were gone, they were dead, and that was about it. Then there was a quick, you know, a critical chart, and you could put those on the back of those little cards that Jeremy made, and you were all good to go. But as far as, getting into a game where I'm doing all this fine-tuning and this micromanaging at this point, I don't think so.
Yeah. Well, I have a lot of nostalgia for Battletech, so that's part of it. But what's funny about the game is you can definitely play it at any level you like and make it as not complex as you want.
Yeah.
But what happens is the complexity calls to people. Like, if you look at the Quick Strike rules, right? I knew that if I brought out the full-on Battletech rules with six players and everybody never playing in years, they'd have just been like, it would have did exactly what Craig said, would have grinded to a halt. So instead I brought out the quick strike rules, which are fast and dirty, and was like, wait, where's the complexity? I want the torso twist. I want, and I'm like thinking, no, you don't. but they said they did. You know, so what happens is it calls to you, but then it does. It just, it adds, it's a game that rewards commitment. And if you're the kind of person who really wants to just sink your teeth into one game and have a really good value and just go deeper and deeper into our universe and really just love it, and that it's a great game for that. And it's a good solid rule set. It's a nice game, but it does have a little long play time. But I think it's great. I rated a 4+, but I'll give it a +1 if you are a like as Raef mentioned, if you like the detail crunchy games. It's not that the rules are super complicated here. It's not like you're figuring out velocity vectors and stuff. It's just that just that there's a lot of little rules to keep track of, and it's not even really that. It's just there's lots of stages in the process to complete an action. Even just the bit of tracking your declarations of you know, attacks and stuff. Most of it's been phased out in modern games because it's just too much to track. I think it's still a great game. It really, playing that little game wants me to play more. And as Raef said, there's lots of other games to choose from, but it's just a really solid game, and I think people will like it. So if you've been thinking about Battletech for a while, take a look. It's definitely worth a look.
Yeah, I think so too. Yep.
From the dawn of time we came, rolling dice down through the centuries, we are the D6 generation. Here we stand, and here we fall.
History won't care. Now it's time to talk about our friends at Geek Nation Tours. Now, I want you to play along with me here, Raef and Craig. What I want you to do open up your web browser.
Yeah.
Yep.
And type in geeknationtours.com.
Yep.
And click on the upcoming tours link.
Okay.
Now you tell me which of these tours looks. I'll start. You tell me which one of these looks really coolest to you. And I have to say that the geeking out with Supernatural. But how about Mexican Gaming Holiday November, right around my birthday? How does that? That looks awesome. Yeah. So I'm gonna go check that one out. Let's see. Oop, it looks awesome. You get to go to Mexican Holiday in, how do you pronounce that word there? Hukatol. Does that look right?
I don't know. I'm not sure at all how you would pronounce any of those.
It looks like a really awesome luxury resort. They're going to have all kinds of gaming going on. There you go. Hukatol. They're going to have all kinds of gaming going on there.
Bonanza, Stone Age, Ticket to Ride.
Yeah, look at all the games. Just basically.
Jenga, baby!
So you basically get to go to a great resort in Mexico.
Wasabi!
And then enjoy all these great board games while you see all the great sights of Mexico. That sounds fantastic.
That's awesome.
How about you, Raef? What looks good on the upcoming tour for you there?
I was still looking at the Mexican one since I can speak a little Spanish. I liked the the woman lying on the side, of course, caught my attention. So that's the Adepticon Non-Geek Spouse Tour.
Yeah, see, that's the kind of stuff they do. Geek Nation Tours always make sure that if you want to bring your significant other, and you're a geek, but they're not, let's say, they have options for them to go have fun while you're busy playing in a tournament. Let's say you're going to Adepticon. You're going to put the smackdown on some 40K players. But meanwhile, your wife's like, but I want her to have something fun and relaxing to do while you're doing all the crazy man stuff.
Go on a Chicago film tour.
Nice.
It's weird, Raef, that you didn't want to do the signature Battlefield series, Gettysburg and the Battlefields of the Civil War tour.
Well, when I scrolled down and I saw that, that'd be my next thing to check out.
Oh, you know where I want to go? June 15th, 2012, Lock and Load. Privateer Press's tournament, a big event. That's like their games day, and you get to get a tour of the whole area, Seattle and everything.
Not to name drop or anything, but Matt Wilson wants the three of us to go to that.
That'd be awesome. I can't wait. So that looks really cool, too. I mean, there's so many different things. And what Geek Nation Tours does is they set up these tours to go to these great cons and other events, and then when you get there, not only do you attend the con, right, but what else happens, Craig?
You've got all kinds of cool stuff where you can you'll get an orientation dinner by somebody who knows what they're talking about, so you don't miss anything cool. You get in addition to that sort of tour-based thing, you also get really cool stuff that's happening locally that's not specifically to the con.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So, for instance, if you're going to Lock and Load, there's
Future of Flight Aviation Center and the Boeing Tour.
Right.
Experience Music Project and Science Fiction Museum. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff. Every one of these tours is chock full of not just the specific event that you're destined to go for, you're the destination you're going for. There's also all kinds of other stuff that's specific to that local area as well.
Exactly. Hey, if you go to the Gettysburg tour, the Perry brothers are going to speak to you.
Nice. Ooh. How cool
about
is that?
About their sculpting experience and Gettysburg reenactment experience.
That is fantastic. So be sure to check out the Geek... I'm sorry, it's just geeknationtours.com.
This edition of Jevver Notice is brought to you by Amanda Pike, who would like to wish her handsomely hirsute husband, Marvelous Dave, a fantastic 30th birthday, and outrageously lucky powers to his dice-throwing arm. The whole arm? Wow. Anyway, I'm not sure exactly how to tackle this. I had all kinds of grandiose plans, and I was going to be kind of snide and kind of smarmy, and Gen Con, I just got home last night at 12:40 in the morning, and now it's 7:40 at night the next night, so it's, but you know what, I've had probably one of the worst days of my life. And so, I'm afraid once again, well, I'm going to try to get some Gen Con observations and Jevver Notice is in at the end, but you see, all kinds of little minor. Do you ever notice that some things really put life in perspective for you? And little inconveniences like your plane was delayed, or you had to run the one gate over to get to your connecting flight. Little things like that, they just don't matter so much. I had a day like that today, kind of. I mean, we had little... Gen Con was awesome. I loved meeting everybody. I met so many people. Shout out to the Apple Dumpling Gang! But anyway. Right before I left, though, we had a really scary event happen, and Kai, my giant German Shepherd, which all of you have heard at one point or another, lunged at my son, Reese. Not in an aggressive attack stance, dog people will know what I'm talking about, but in a corrective stance, he was trying to correct Reese's behavior or something that he thought he was seeing that was wrong. But when he did it, he pushed his whole open mouth up against Reese's face. I didn't see this. Karen saw this. And Kai is very much Karen's dog. If I had seen this, I would have been horrified. There would have been no way we would have been getting rid of the dog, though, because Karen wouldn't have believed me. But she was the one who witnessed it the day before I left for Gen Con. And so most of my Gen Con was spent dealing with this emotional element of we talked to dog trainers, we talked to our families, and everyone agreed that if we can find Kai a good place, we can't really keep him with us in the house anymore because we've just lost. Reese was fine. Reese was totally okay. Wasn't a scratch on him. He was really scared. But, you know, he's a great kid. He bounced right back. He's not at all, you know, nervous about Kai anymore or, you know, anything like that. But the problem is that we really don't trust him. I mean, what if he did that and Reese moved a little bit and it really was just a really dangerous situation. So I went to Gen Con. It was like 12 hours, literally 12 hours after this happened that I got picked up by Nicole and Russ to go to Gen Con. So this was a large factor in the fact that I really was honestly feeling very agoraphobic over the course of the whole weekend. And I was just really emotionally not on an even keel. We have two dogs. So all weekend long, my wife has been going through an adoption agency. We found there were 15 families in the first day who wanted to adopt Kai. So, I mean, we're doing it the right way. We're going through all the right channels, and he's going to be a very happy dog when we're done. But anyway, our other dog, obviously, of course, I've mentioned him, is Benny the Beagle, who we rescued from a shelter many years ago, well, 3 or 4 years ago now, I guess. And he's old, and he's getting up there, and, you know, he's losing some of his bodily function control. But, you know, he's still a good dog. So I got home last night at probably about 1:30 by the time I got home. And Karen meets me at the door with a, we have to talk. And of course, you know, your brain fills up all kinds of stories. And I want to tell you about how my plane was delayed and how this person was awesome and this person was annoying. And she's like, no, we need to talk. I'm like, oh, good. Okay. So the long and the short of it was that Benny had basically gotten very, very ill very, very quickly over the weekend and had, he was really not in good shape. We had an appointment this morning at a vet. I thought we were going into the appointment for he's really not doing well. You probably have a couple months to say goodbye meeting. And it wasn't. It was a full liver failure, massive internal bleeding. The time has probably come to ease him into, you know what I'm saying. And so completely emotionally unprepared for that. So that's what my morning was like. This afternoon, we met with our first adoptive family, and all they kept saying was, oh my God, he's such an amazing dog. How can you let him go? So that's been my day. I won't go any further into all the details, but so suffice it to say that I want to have this done so we can get this episode out to you. But I'm just not there brain-wise. So I'll try. I'll try, though. Did you ever notice how many people at a huge convention do cosplay? They call it cosplay, but it really shouldn't be called cosplay. It should just be called cos, because there's not a lot of play going on, if you know what I'm saying. Okay, so if you're going to dress yourself up, for instance, like the assassin from Assassin's Creed, then you shouldn't be allowed to casually take the escalator. It's that kind of thing that I'm okay. If you're going to dress like Conan the Barbarian, then you shouldn't be taking your cell phone calls right there in the hallway. Not a lot of play, a lot of cos. And of course it's Gen Con. Not as much, so there's not as much cosplay as say Dragon Con or I'm sure Comic Con, but there's a lot. And my friends were all very funny because they came up with an elaborate rating system on how to rate the various different costumes. I saw some that were amazing. I saw some that were just, I shook my head. Why would you ever wear a giant, heavy, full-body, furry dragon costume all weekend long, complete with a giant head? I don't know. But yeah, so that's what I was thinking when I saw the assassin from Assassin's Creed taking the escalator. And another thing is I underscored again how I'm not going to be a Twitter person, and I just can't be. Spending the first day and a half with Russ and Nicole, it was like spending the day with people who live with one foot in a different universe. And so it was very odd. We were walking around, and of course, each of them had a phone in their palm, and they were looking at the phone, and they were typing with their thumbs, and they were giggling at what they were reading, and they were sharing screens back. Oh, look what this person read. Oh, look what this. And I'm like, okay, all righty. And it was just very odd. It was just very odd. And I mean, we all know how much those two tweet, right? I mean, we do. But I hadn't ever experienced it from the, you know, from the realm from which they were tweeting. And boy, that's a lot of tweets. But anyway, so that was funnier when I was thinking of it before today happened. So I think I may just spare you. And you know what? I'm going to play Quarriers with Karen tonight is what I'm going to do. I don't even care if she wants to or not. I'm going to sit her down. I'm going to play this little dice rolling game, and we're going to have fun. Gosh darn it. Yeah. So anyway, thank you for listening. Thank you for listening to me vent. Thank you all for a great Gen Con. It's because of all of you that we're able to do that. And thank every one of you who came to our Play-By-Mob event. I hope you had a good time. Thank every one of you for saying hi, for stopping me, us in the halls and in the hallways and in the rooms. It really meant a lot to us. And thanks for all the compliments. Tongue-in-cheek or otherwise, on our shirts. And that's all I've got to say about all of that, so I'm just going to say good night.
Achievement unlocked. You've made it to the end of another D6 Generation episode, the podcast whose humor has universally been acclaimed as not too horrible. Please let us know what you thought of the show by either emailing us at info@thed6generation.com or by posting in our official D6G episode thread at the top of the DACA discussions forum on DACADACA.com. If for some inexplicable reason you actually enjoyed this show, you can help others find out about it by leaving positive reviews on iTunes. See you in 2 weeks. Thanks for listening, and happy gaming.
The theme from Total Fangirl comes from the soundtrack of The Last Night on Earth, The Zombie Game, courtesy of Flying Frog Productions, and is a composition of Mary Beth Magalanes.
Is that what's happening?
I don't
can't hold the plane for one person.
No, we can't.
I have to pee.
Well, it depends who that one person is.
Yeah, right. All right. So I think we should, let's try to leave the door open in case somebody shows up late, but I think we're ready to get started. So we're just going to jump in with, are you ready?
Yeah, I don't know if this is going to be safe with the door open, but we'll go for it.
All right. John, you got, is the record button pressed there, sir? Awesome.
John, do you see what we, this is what we deal with here.
This is what we deal with, John.
You can't be too careful,
this is
people.
It.
You really can't.
To press record all the time.
Uh-huh. Like I just did right there on my record. Mm-hmm. All right. So without further ado.
Wait. John, did you press record?
He's going to unplug everything in
okay.
2 seconds.
All right.
You're depressed?
What?
How do you treat him?
Nice.
It is sad. Sad, John.
All right.
All right. Can we start this thing? Russ, let's go.
Right, you're on. Can you?
Ready? You're not going to give me the rapid fire in five, four.
Rapid fire in five, episode 85. Rapid fire, live from GenCon. Five, four, three.